And today, the University of Delaware Blue Hens will be back on Tubby Raymond Field, attempting to get back in the win column against the Black Bears of Maine. You're listening to 94.7 WDSD-FM. I'm Scott Klatskin in the Valley Days broadcast booth presented by Shell alongside Matt Janis, and on-site producer Kyle Fox. On the field handling sound is Mike Diodati. Reporting on the sideline is former All-CAA defensive lineman Michael Attenrasse. 2-2 Delaware versus a 1-3 Maine team, both 0-1 in conference play, looking to get to 500 and avoid a deep 0-2 hole to start CAA play.
Yeah, this is a big game for Delaware. There's no doubt about it. It is, quite frankly, an absolute must-win game. They dug themselves a hole last week. We talked about the difference between losing that football game you could have lived with, losing it the way you did, very difficult to swallow for these Hens. To their credit, they have been very good at leaving the past to the past, not lingering on a loss and not feeling full of themselves after a victory. They will be tested to try to do that again today, not let JMU beat them twice. They've got to get some balance going offensively, and they've got to get back to their identity on the defensive end. Got to make sure if you're Delaware, you take better angles, you sure tacklers like you have been all season long up until the last 2 weeks, and you've got to be physical. That was the one thing Dave Brock said he thought was missing from his football team last week against JMU. Wants to get it back today.
Delaware leads the all-time series 23-10. This is the 34th meeting between these two teams. They have not played in two seasons. Delaware needed a couple years off after losing 62-28 back in 2013. Little rain on the field. Let's send down to the field and Michael Attenrasse. What's going on, Mike?
Guys, it is really wet and the rain is starting to pick up just a little bit down here. You know what? But this is football weather. I remember having games like this where it was rainy and just loving it because we knew that the ball was going to more or less stay on the ground, having to go in the trenches and determine a game there. That's the best way to play. It's a good opportunity to create turnovers. Last week, Delaware had zero turnovers, which is not like them. They've produced a lot in the games 1, 2, and 3. Let's see if we can make it up this week and produce some turnovers on the defensive side.
That would be nice for the Hens if they get the ball back when their defense is on the field. Delaware won the toss. They chose to defer. Maine will get the football first. They'll go left to right as we see it, driving towards the student section. It's parents and family weekend. Good turnout despite what is a rainy day, like Mike mentioned, here in Newark. Let's get to the starters first for the University of Maine Black Bears, brought to you by National 5-10. Dan Collins is the quarterback. Nigel Beckford and Josh Mack will rotate, but Beckford will get the start. Micah Wright, Jaleel Reed, and Jared Asumar, the wide receivers. Jeremy Salmon is the tight end. Demby, Reddington, Andrews, Brooks, Levy across the line. We'll get to the Delaware starters after the kick as Jake Roth has it teed up, and he'll kick it towards the Delaware scoreboard in the north end zone. Back to return, DeAndre Scott, the return man, transferred from Arizona. Roth has it up in the air, and we are back in Delaware Stadium. Roth will take it with two hands, 1 foot in the end zone, and he'll fake the flip to his other return man at the 15-yard line. Flag is thrown as Scott gets past the 20-yard line to the 23. It was Torza on the tackle. We'll see what the flag is about on the return.
Try to bluff the reverse and get Delaware to over-pursue something we have seen at times from the Hens, but a good job by Delaware to stay at home on the backside. They had the full field covered.
Holy, 24 in the receiving team. 10-yard penalty, first down.
That's Sid Masola Demurin, the defensive back on the hold to push Maine back after return from DeAndre Scott. The starters for Delaware defensively, John Nassib, Blaine Woodson, Bilal Nichols, and Cam Kitchen on the line. Jackson Bell Reeder are your linebackers. Malcolm Brown, Nasir Adderley are the corners. We did hear that Justin Watson practiced this week. We might be able to see him. Jones and Torza are the safeties.
Brock is livid with this spot. The ball's at the 14-yard line. The return didn't even get out to the 14-yard or to the 24-yard line. They marked it at the 23, so the ball can't be at the 14. It can't be 10 from the spot, and you end up back. I mean, if you would return the ball to the 45-yard line, or if you return the ball to the 20-yard line and the penalty happened at the 45, you wouldn't go 10 from the spot there. They've got to move it back a little bit. They moved it back 6 inches. Brock is still not happy with that.
Yeah, and he shouldn't be. You described it perfectly, Matt. The ball is spotted where it should not be at the 14, but it looks like that's where this drive will start. First play of the game with Dan Collins waiting just for the signal from the officiating crew that he can go. The running back is Josh Mack. So Mack, after 151 yards a week ago, will get the start. The true freshman. Two tight ends go in motion to the left side from the right as Collins awaits the snap. Collins gets the snap. It gives it to the true freshman, Mack, running wide to the left side. And Charles Bell is there to push him out. Also, Torza in on the stop. As we mentioned, Josh Mack, the Stats National Freshman of the Week after his performance against Bryan a week ago.
Stats honored him because his stats were pretty good, but a great job by the Delaware defense that time. You were talking about pursuit. Eight guys in the box, rainy weather, run first offense. You're anticipating that they will keep the ball to the ground, and the Hens were all over it, setting the edge and then flowing the football.
Salmon and Dunn at tight end. Double tight end set for Maine. Second and eight from the 16. A play action. Collins underneath, caught by Micah Wright, his favorite target, at the 21-yard line, up to the 22. Anthony Jackson in on the stop.
One of the things you always worry about with a freshman running back, how will he handle pass protection? Great cut block that time by Mack. Nassib came off the end. That's an awful tough assignment for a back to end up on a D lineman one-on-one. And he took Nassib out and allowed that high percentage throw to be completed for Maine. And what a big difference between what would have been a third and eight, now a third and short.
Micah Wright with his first catch of the day on third down and two from the Maine 22-yard line. Tight end goes in motion, I formation, and Collins will go to the running back. But Nassib not having any of it. A tackle for loss from Big John Nassib. And fourth down coming up for the Black Bears.
Boy, an indecisive run that time from Beckford. They wanted to go off tackle, and he kind of took an in-between angle. He wasn't sure whether he should bounce it wide or whether he should go right off that left tackle. And as a result of his hesitation, it allows Nassib, who's unblocked, to just chase the play down for the backside. Good quickness from Nassib, and a good job to hustle and stay in the play.
James DeMartini coming on to punt this one away. Troy Gallen back to return for Delaware. Fourth and three for the Maine 21. And Gallen leveled as he catches the football. No fair catch signal. A risky move by the redshirt sophomore. 46 yards on the punt. No return as Troy Gallen was sent flying backwards. Let's get to the starters for Delaware on offense. Joe Walker is the quarterback. Wes Hill's the running back. Deontay Cherry, Jamie Jarman, and Vinny Papali are the wide receivers. Brandon Whaley, we should see him back this week at tight end. Trump, Lewis, Kern, Robinson, and Bozick across the offensive line. We'll get you the main starters after the first play from Delaware. This drive starting 13:07. First quarter, and from their own 32. Walker under center. It's actually going to be Scarf starting at the tight end position. And the first play of the game for Delaware offense goes to Wes Hills. Outside at the 40, and he is tripped up as he gets to the 45-yard line. Tackle made by Manny Patterson, one of the starters on defense for the Black Bears. They'll get to the rest. Pat Ricard on defensive end. Nose tackles Darius Green. Egwuno on the defensive tackle. Defensive end Dakota Tarbox. The linebackers Sheffield, Brown, and Hume. Injury to Malumba Chamanga knocks him out. Patterson and Good are the corners to safeties, Matovu and Scott. How about Wes Hills? He's averaging double digits per carry this season and keeps it up there.
Just so quick to the outside. It's phenomenal. One great seal block by the right tackle, and then Hills pretty much did the rest.
18 yards on that play. The Hens are at midfield. Second play of the drive. It's a first down, and it's Joe Walker with some space at the 45, 40, 35, and down he goes. He fumbled the football. It came out, but he was down. He was down at the 34-yard line as the tackle was made by DeAndre Scott. So the Hens go right side to Hills, left side to Joe Walker. Their first two plays, and both for first downs. What a run by Joe Walker.
A zone read that time for Walker. Good decision. Again, you have to over-pursue to try to chase down Hills. He's so quick, so electric to the outside. And as he reads that defensive end collapse down, Walker keeps it, and there's just nobody on the outside. And Joe uses his quickness to get to the second level.
Joe Walker will go under center this time, right behind big Brody Kern. 12 minutes first quarter, first down and 10. Maine showing some pressure from the ends as Benjamin Davis bluffed on a blitz. Joe Walker found him. Single back is Wes Hills, and it's Wes Hills trying to change direction in the backfield. Does so, gets out to the 30, so a four-yard pickup. Sterling Sheffield with the tackle, a sophomore from Mullica Hill, New Jersey.
And that's the difference between Wes Hills and most running backs in this league. That's a 1 or 2 yard gain for almost anybody, even good running backs in this league. Hill's ability to stop, start, shift left, shift right, and get back to acceleration. I know it's only a 3.5 yard run, but it really was. He got stopped in the backfield, shifted right, moved back to his left, and then darted forward. And now you're on schedule still offensively.
Staying on schedule is always key with this team, and now they are. Second and six, ball ball on the 30 of Maine. It's Joe Walker again to West Hills, running wide, has a hold to the right side at the 20. Knocked out of bounds near the 15-yard line by Jason Matovu, and the Hens are rolling on this opening drive. Another first down.
You know who's had a fantastic start? The right tackle, Jethro Pepe. What a kick-out block there. He had the seal block on the first run from Hills that allowed West to get to the outside, and that time just demolished the linebacker and allowed Hills again to get the corner.
A nice job by the offensive line. We talked about the improvement needing to be made, and they're doing so thus far. First and 10 for Delaware from the main 16. In the red zone are the Hens, 12 of 15 so far this year. Inside the 20, Hills is the running back, and Hills with some power up the middle. He gets to the 10-yard line, broke a tackle to get there, and a pickup of 6 on first down.
I like what they're trying to do. They're spreading Maine out a little bit and then using Hills' quickness to just kind of beat the defense to the point there. As Hills right now with 3 wide receivers, 2 spin to the wide side, they have to bring the safety down, and it's just opening things. They've run a lot to the weak side. They've run straight ahead with the safety not there, and they're just playing a numbers game up front using Hills' quickness to their advantage.
Randolph will come into the game for the first time in the offset eye. Yokeman as the fullback. Scarf is the tight end on second down and 4. Randolph's first carry, and it doesn't go for much. Maybe a loss. I think he dove back to the line of scrimmage. And then Pat Ricard, the CAA defensive player of the week, in on the stop.
Fantastic job by Ricard to shed the block, get to the backfield. Another tackle for loss for him. And again, Delaware goes power there. And Maine, I think, in this stage of the game, kind of has to just dare Delaware, especially at this point of the field, throw the football on second down and short. If you want to do it, we think we can guard you up one-on-one. And they just flood the box, and Ricard makes a fantastic individual play.
6 plays all run so far for Delaware. 3rd down and 4 from the Maine 10-yard line. Hills back in as the single back. Ricky Emerson split out to the far side right. 2 wide receivers to the left side, including Scarf. And Walker will give it to Wes Hills, trying to grind his way for a first down, and he did. The second effort got him there. There was 4 white jerseys bottling him up at around the 8-yard line, and he slipped across, got all the way to the 5, and makes it first and goal.
Very similar to what we saw last week against JMU from the Delaware defense. Maine that time trying so hard to pursue to the edge. Their linebacker just completely left his gap. Hills saw it. Got a piece of the shoulder pad, but that's not enough to bring Hills down, and just darts forward to move the sticks.
No score, first drive for Delaware, and Walker in the shotgun. The give is to Wes Hills, racing towards that end zone, but hit just a yard shy of a score. Connor Walsh, the defensive end, stops 6.
Again, Walsh collapsing down, and you get the feeling zone read is going to be there today for Delaware. I think if Walker had kept that one, he probably walks to the pylon, but that was a straight run call. But that'll be something that Sean Devine and company keep in their back pocket for later in the game. We already saw it work once today.
Split backs behind Walker from the 1-yard line. Randolph and Hills both in the ball game. Behind Walker, it'll be Randolph, and Randolph does what Randolph does, a touchdown. 6th time this season, Jalen Randolph has gotten points on the board for the Hens.
Well, when you're in tight to the goal line, the beauty of the situation there for Delaware, the fact that you have to defend both sides of the field there if you're the Hens. I mean, left and right. And what Delaware was able to do, get a good kick out block for Connor Bozick. Randolph trying to go to the outside. Bozick pulling wide. And just with the linebacker having to stay on the backside to make sure it wouldn't be Hills. Not enough bodies. It takes 1 block, and Bozick throws a perfect one.
Bozick with you mentioned it, a huge block. We saw it on the replay here at Delaware Stadium. What a block that was for Bozick. The right side, you mentioned Pepe on that drive as well. Now Rango with the PAT, and that's good. Your PNC Bank timeout score after Delaware goes 9 plays, 68 yards. Delaware 7, Maine nothing.
Media timeout.
At Texas Roadhouse in Bear, Delaware, our story.
Little details, truly a game of inches. Small things people don't see. It's about putting yourself in the best position. It starts here. The work isn't flashy, it's not glamorous, but it's necessary. Because after all, the future is now.
Hello.
Nice to meet you.
Welcome, welcome. Today I'm going to show you the all-new 2016 Chevy Cruze and ask you what you think. But here's the catch. You can only answer in emojis. What emoji would you use to describe the design?
I think it's sexy.
It has available built-in 4G LTE Wi-Fi.
Rock on, that's excellent. We got Wi-Fi.
This car gets an EPA estimated 40 miles per gallon highway.
This car is like a unicorn. It's magical.
Raymond Field, and the Hens gave the fans what they were waiting for, a 9-play, 68-yard drive. Jalen Randolph capped it off with a 1-yard run, and it's 7-0 Blue Hens, 8:09 first quarter.
That drive very similar to the way Delaware started their first game here at Delaware Stadium way back in early September against Delaware State, just dominant and right down their throats with the run. This time, not a single pass try for Delaware. They only got into one third down. They were able to run downhill to pick it up. Wes Hills coming through, and then Jalen Randolph, as he has done over the course of this season, he's been the closer on these drives,
yes,
able to work his way into the ends. I believe that's 6 already now of the season for Randolph. Fantastic effort by him. But most impressive, the offensive line. Just a dominant start up front. Pepe and Bozic, especially on that right side. A couple of big-time kick-out blocks. The holes are big. Hills is certainly helping him with his electricity, but the holes are big. Good job.
I hope Randolph at least takes Hills to lunch at one of the dorms at least, because Hills, 51 yards on the drive. Randolph with 1 yard, but the one that counted for a touchdown. Here we go. As a kickoff is made, now bobbled at the 10, running at the 20, 25, 30. Is DeAndre Scott, Anthony Jackson in on the tackle, as was Nasir Adderley. So some better field position, no penalties this time on the return for Maine, and they'll get the ball for the second time with 8:02 first quarter.
Now, Scott, this is a situation Maine's been here before. Just last week, they fell behind Bryant by a score of 21-0. We're able to rally back for a win, but you'd like to think there's a crater-sized difference between Bryant and Delaware. I was trying to figure out the right word without being too insulting to the folks up there at Bryant, but you wouldn't think that Maine could afford to fall more than one score behind in this game today.
You'd be surprised at the lack of listeners from the Bryant school that are tuning in. First and 10 as the tight end goes in motion to start from the Maine 30. Nigel Beckford is the back, and he tries to go up the middle, but that Delaware stout defense is there once again. Troy Reeder with the tackle, his first of the day.
You know, Maine is a team that has gotten behind it in some games. And Dave Rockstead, watching the film, he thought maybe they went away from the run a little bit quicker than they would have liked to. And thought they really stuck with it last week against Bryant. I think they have to be careful sticking with it too much here against Delaware, because the Hens front is just eating up Maine's offensive line right now. Big time push at establishing a new line of scrimmage in the backfield.
Beckford in at running back. He stands next to Collins in shotgun form on second down and 9. It's a passing play. Collins throws one on the line, and it's caught by Jaleel Reed. His 14th catch of the season. Good for a first down to the 41-yard line, and that was a throw on a rope from Dan Collins. He's 2 of 2.
We're talking about a crater-sized hole between Delaware and Bryant. That was a pea-sized hole of a window that he just threw that football through. I mean, I think it was about the size of the football, to be blatantly honest. Reeder just came through. He tried to slow up and get his hand on it, but that is an incredibly risky throw that time from Dan Collins.
Collins has thrown some risky passes over the last 2 weeks. 6 interceptions for Collins. First and 10, and they flip it to the wide receiver, but Troy Reeder is right there, not fooling him. A gain of 2 perhaps at the 42-yard line, and they flipped it to Ernest Edwards, who's carried the ball now 3 times this season, but that's good scouting right there.
Yeah, they'll technically go down as a pass, but Reeder sets the edge, stays at home on the backside, and you know, that play is entirely reliant upon what the movement of the offensive line of Reeder taking a false step, and then the sweep action getting the step for the receiver to beat him to the edge. Reeder's so athletic, and he's so wise. No chance for that play to work whatsoever.
Trips to the left side for Maine from their own 43-yard line on 2nd and 8, down 7-0. A screen pass is thrown, caught by Reed at the 45, 46, and he's brought down. Ray Jones is there. Also, Charles Bell on the stop. Jones 17th tackle of the season.
How about Malcolm Brown just throwing Jordan Dunn like he was a sack of potatoes? They're trying to set up that quick screen. If Dunn can set that block, there's open space to the outside. He's got to push him to the boundary. Instead, it was Brown that pushed Dunn about 10 yards out of the play. That forced it back inside to the pursuit and allowed Jones to go get him.
Now split back on third down and 5. In motion goes Micah Wright. He's the threat. They've got to know where he is on third down. Collins throwing, completion at the 48-yard line. Bell slowed up the receiver for Maine in time for help to come, and the tackle was made short of the first down marker, which was at the 49 of Delaware. So it'll be fourth down and 2. A nice job again by the Delaware defense on third down.
Well, you get pretty much everything you want there. If you're Maine, that ball is thrown in stride, and it's a situation where you gotta trust your best wide receiver, Micah Wright. He didn't even really have to break a tackle. He had to just make sure he fell forward and he gets that first down. But a fantastic effort by Bell. He patrols that middle so well, just got enough of him and kept his momentum going backwards and allowed Brown to come in and finish it up.
Papali back to return. He'll wave for it at the 17, 18 yard line. 4:46 remaining. 33-yard punt by James DeMartini. Let's head down to the sideline at Michael Atanarasa.
Guys, you already see a difference in the defensive scheme and in the attitude that Delaware has come out with today. They're putting safeties in the box on early downs, and then later on, you saw right there, Delaware playing off, playing the sticks, and then being aggressive after the short pass was thrown. I really like what these guys are doing. They're playing with a lot of energy. They got the ball back to the offense. If the offense could go down and score right here, you might see the game turn way far away from where Maine could catch up in this first quarter.
Thank you, Mike. The 6th annual Buffalo Run at Buffalo Wild Wings on South Main Street in Newark is Saturday, October 15th, starting at 11 a.m. This event benefits the Boys and Girls Club of Greater Newark, and registration begins at 10 a.m. Enjoy the race and then enjoy the Buffalo Wild Wings after party, featuring a buffet of delicious Buffalo Wild Wings food and beer for those participants over 21. It's the 6th annual Buffalo Run on October 15th. Details and online registration at bwwbuffalorun.com. That's my kind of walk, where you just get the after party. I'll walk as far as you want if you get an after party like that.
That's what our booth is capable of, exercise-wise.
I watched Matt Janis fly up these Delaware Stadium stairs earlier today.
Can't ask for a better start than this, though, if you're the Hens, Scott. I mean, Mike alluded to, defensively, it just looks like a different group. Yes, Maine's not as quick. They're not as athletic to the edge, but there is a different pep in Delaware's step right now. Shorter tackling, better angles in pursuit, and most importantly, they get this early lead running downhill. I'd keep it on the ground.
Delaware will start with Randolph as the single back from their 18. Play action. Walker rolling out and throws it at the feet of Jalen Randolph. Good coverage downfield as Papali and Cherry were covered, so Walker decides just to live to see another down.
Well, again, they want to go the deep post to Papali. He is covered to safety, stayed at home, didn't bite on the play action, which is surprising considering how much success Delaware had on the ground first time, but didn't have enough time to find his leak out. Randolph's supposed to go to the flat there, and Walker didn't have an opportunity to find him. Good decision by Joe to throw the football away, but you'd like to see him just get an extra half second or so.
Trips to the right side. It's second down and 10 for the Delaware 18. Hens lead 7-0, 4:38. First quarter, and Walker's going to keep it himself this time. Gets out to the 24-yard line. So that's a pickup of 6 yards before Darius Green, the senior, makes his 10th tackle of the year.
Good job by Walker. Now gets him back on schedule. And Maine's got to defend both the run and the pass. And that's obviously where Delaware's at its most effective. Third and long is certainly not a high percentage spot for Delaware right now. It's a percentage spot for not many teams, but especially the Hens. Third and 4, they picked up a huge percentage of those here in the early going this season.
Delaware 9th in the CAA in third down conversions this season. They'll need 4 yards from the 24 on their own side of the field. Randolph is the back, and Randolph is carrying the football to the right side. Has a big hole. First down past the 30. And again, those blockers on that right side having their way with the Maine defensive line. Randolph that time moves the sticks.
And remember, you miss your all-conference middle linebacker, and everybody else has to shift the position. Austin Brown in there. Zachary Hugh bounces to a new position, and it just doesn't seem like I mean, granted, I agree with you. Delaware's offensive line is doing a fantastic job, but it doesn't feel like the fits are very solid right now for Maine at that linebacking core against the run.
Tackle was made by Benjamin Davis from that linebacker position. Now trips to the left side for Walker on first and 10 from his own 32. 3:25 first quarter. Read play, and they'll give it to Randolph with nowhere to go as there was good pursuit by the man you just mentioned, Austin Brown, starting to replace the all-conference linebacker, Christoph Bolumba-Jamonga.
And the other thing that you lose with his absence is he's your quarterback on the field. He's the guy in the huddle that calls the defensive plays out. Now, Maine's not a traditional huddle team. They look more to the sideline for the signals, but he's still the guy that's in charge of making sure everybody's in the right spot. He's supposed to move the line. He's supposed to shift the linebackers, call out the positions, strong side of the formation. That's an awful lot that you put onto the plate of his understudy.
Malama Chimanga, 6th in 2013 for the Jerry Rice Award. He's been in this league a while, and he's been phenomenal. Second down and 9 for the Delaware 33-yard line. They give it to number 33. That's Randolph at the 40-yard line. Down he goes. Good second down pickup. Makes it third down and short. Tackle made by Zachary Hugh, the starting will today, as Austin Brown moved over.
Delaware is doing to Maine what Wake and JMU did to Delaware. They are dominating second down and are just setting up third and shorts. I mean, how many times have we seen them in second and 10? It's at least 3 here in this early going where it's second and 9, second and 10. You look at the scoreboard on the next play, it's 3rd and 2, 3rd and 3, 3rd and 4. Delaware can pick those up. They already have one on this drive.
3rd and 2 now for Delaware. 2 minutes remaining. First quarter, Hens up 7-0. This is their second drive of the game. They scored a 9-play drive to start things. Can they extend this drive? They're 2 of 2 on third down, looking to make it 3 of 3, and they do so with Jalen Randolph. Some shiftiness to get his way out to the 43, and that's a first down.
Maine tried to clog everything up. We were talking about playing downhill. About 9 guys lined up within 6 or 7 yards of the line of scrimmage, trying to clog all the holes. They did make Randolph stop his feet, but Jalen finds just a little bit of open space. And now I think we see Thomas Jefferson in there for the first time today.
Jefferson, the sophomore, he'll be split out to the far side right. Empty backfield. Last year's rookie of the year in the CAA on offense. 1st and 10 for Delaware, 90 seconds left in the first quarter. They've got the ball on their own 43, driving, and a quarterback run design up the middle for Joe Walker. No hesitation. He gets the 47-yard line, a pickup of 4.
What would you say the percentage? I mean, eyeballing it, I don't have numbers in front of me, but the percentage that Delaware, when they go empty, is running quarterback draw. It's got to be at least 90% so far this season. And yet teams still don't seem to be identifying it quite yet, or the Hens, to their credit, are just executing it incredibly well. Because, I mean, everybody can hear it in our dish. They're calling draw. And you still get 4 yards out of the deal.
Now, Thomas Jefferson will join Walker at a shotgun form on 2nd down and 6. Still in Delaware territory at the 47. Ends up 7-0. Jefferson looking at his first carry, but this is going to be a passing play, a screen thrown to Cherry. Cherry cannot break a tackle, which would have allowed him to get upfield with not much in front of him, but a nice job in space to make the stop by Jason Matovu, his second tackle of the day.
I'd be surprised if Delaware runs his third down play here in this opening quarter. I think you take your time, make sure everybody's on the right page. That's the problem with the screens. When there's nothing vertical down the field and you're seeing man coverage across the board, sometimes a lot harder to hit those quick hitters. That jet screen that time, there's just no space, nowhere to go.
It's the 16th catch of the season for Deontay Cherry. And you're right, Matt, they're going to let this clock go all the way down to 0. A good first quarter of action for Delaware. They had the ball one time. They marched down the field. It was a 9-play drive and it ended with 7 points for the Hens. This time, they'll have the 9th play of this drive when we come back on 94.7 WDSD. A quick first quarter of action. We'll have more. Your PNC Bank timeout score, Delaware 7, Maine nothing.
Watch all your
Want more Delaware Athletics content? Click around here on Hens All Access for live games, game highlights, features, and more. And follow your favorite Hens on Twitter for the latest updates.
It's your turn to mix it up at Mickey D's. For a limited time, choose any two. From mouth-watering new picks to tasty classics. McPick 2 for $5. Enjoy the choice.
Rush hour or relax hour. It's your choice. Ride more, save more, do more. Dart, moving forward.
Lead 7-0 over Maine. Getting ready to start the second quarter. It'll be the ninth play of the drive coming up for the Hens. I want to remind our listeners that the Blue Hens Radio Restaurant of the Week is Texas Roadhouse in Bear, Delaware, where they are all about the real quality of hand-cut steaks, fall-off-the-bone ribs, made from scratch sides, and fresh-baked bread. Real value that can be seen all across their everyday menu. Texas Roadhouse in Bear is a hometown favorite. I love working with the owners at Texas Roadhouse. Great people and big Blue Hens supporters. Call ahead for seating. 302-322-3443, located right off of Route 1 and Route 40, Texas Roadhouse, Buckley Boulevard in Bear.
There are very few healthy things about me, but I try to always avoid butter on my bread, not at Texas Roadhouse. You could eat like 4 cups of that stuff. That is unbelievable. Good eating.
Absolutely right. We appreciate their support. Let's get some first half stats as Josh Mack, the freshman UD Star Health Star Watch player after just one carry, 2 yards for Delaware. West Hill, 6 carries, 51 yards. A quarterback comparison, Dan Collins, 5 of 5 with just 24 yards. Joe Walker, 1 of 2, and a no gain to Deontay Cherry on that one. As we start the second quarter, Delaware going left to right towards the student section in the south end zone. And Papali goes in motion on 3rd down and 6 for the Hens. Delaware 3 of 3 on 3rd down. Walker lobbing it towards the sideline, and it's going to be incomplete. Out of bounds goes the throw as Scarf was the target around the 30.
No separation whatsoever there. I mean, it's really kind of a one-option route. They did have Cherry in the flat on the other side, but that's, you're going for Whaley the whole way. And the safety got on him. No window for Walker to try to shoot that one in. Little late with the throw because he had to step up with pressure coming from the edge. And by the time he was late, Whaley was too close to the sideline. There's no window for him to try to float it in.
So we'll see Will Stevenson for the first time today. Will Stevenson, it'll be his 20th punt on the season when he gets it off 4th and 6. And he grabs it to the right side. Some pressure coming, but he boots this one. Micah Wright back to return, backpedaling, diving for it, and catching it off balance, falling at the 4-yard line. 48-yard punt for Will Stevenson. And he's been booting them all season long. He's been a weapon. You know, there was a concern coming into the season. How are we going to replace Eric Anderson, who left after his junior year? One more year of eligibility, but he did graduate. Will Stevenson, transfer from North Carolina State, has been very good for the Hens.
Just kind of got opponents stuck going uphill quite a few times this year. He's really special at flipping the field. That time inside the 10-yard line, and probably a silly fair catch, but the best part about that punt, it was under pressure from the edge. I mean, it was not a perfect snap. He was able to get it, and Keyshawn Wilson coming from the outside, and it didn't faze him at all. He still got off a nice, high spiraling kick.
So Dan Collins will start with the edge of his foot in the end zone, dropping back in the end zone, throwing from the end zone, an incomplete pass as he was looking for Jared Asuma. Ball came out of his chest as Adderley was coming in with some pressure.
Yeah, Adderley's a good physical corner. He's such a sure tackler. He was a little late that time. That should have been a completion. And you're not doing yourself any favors as you're Maine. I like the first down throw. I don't, at least what we have seen so far, think that Maine's going to be able to line up and try to run downhill against this Hens team. You've got to try to soften them up a little bit, but you got to execute. That's a good throw from Collins.
Under center goes Collins this time. Tight end in motion. He retraces the right side. Darian Davis Bay with a lot of speed up the gut. A flag is thrown as he gets out to the 14-yard line. Darian Davis Ray, the sophomore, suspended last week, but back in action this week, and there's a penalty.
Well, he had a hole because Isaiah Brooks hogtied one of the Delaware defensive linemen in the middle. I think it was below
legal Nichols. Shift. 2 men in motion at once. 5-yard penalty, or half the distance to goal. Still second down.
He'll take the 5-yard penalty, but if you're Dave Brock, I mean, there's a reason he's out on the field, palms in the air. How do you miss that hold? We look at it, I mean, how do you miss that hold? They just showed the replay up on the box. He grabs him by the neck, wraps him by the back of the jersey. It would have been a horse collar tackle if he was an offensive player. That is blatant. It really, because it's half the distance to goal, it's not a big deal, but it's concerning that they could possibly miss that moving forward.
It does make it 2nd and 12 from the 3-yard line of Maine. In motion goes Micah Wright, pounds with his feet in the end zone. He's going to drop back. Here comes pressure, screen set up, and dropped. by Davis Ray, the running back. So it's going to be third down and 12, ball on the 3-yard line of Maine with 14:21 remaining in quarter number two.
Well, Hens got away with one there. He dropped that football. It was laying on the ground. The whistle blew, and he came in and popped the back that time. I didn't see who it was. It was amidst some traffic, but he went staggering back. Maine players even started to clap, assuming they were going to get the late hit call. And no flag flies, so big break for Delaware. Got to make sure, you know, you like that you're playing at high speed. You like that you're flowing to the football, but you got to stop once that whistle blew.
Four wide receivers for Maine. Trips to the right side on third down and 12. Collins from the end zone, dropping back. Pressure coming, throwing it. Long for Wright, in stride. Wright catches it at the 36-yard line. Down at the 40 he goes. What a toss from Dan Collins on the money, and his favorite target, Michael Wright, with a 38-yard pickup.
But tell you what, Delaware brought the blitz, and it wasn't picked up. Pressure was in Collins' face, but it's man coverage on the outside. And unfortunately, Justin Watson, that's not the way you wanted to see him return. Just a half step behind, and a perfect throw from Collins. Give him credit for making the tackle, though.
He's got that club on his hands. He missed last week, club on his arm, I should say. Now Collins wide open down the middle of the field on first and 10 from the 40, and a touchdown is scored by Maine. A 60-yard toss from Dan Collins to Ernest Edwards.
Just a seam route, and it's a blown coverage from Delaware. I'm not sure if the safety was supposed to rotate over and pick him up, the linebacker was supposed to get a bump, or what happened, but nobody whatsoever in the vicinity of Edwards. And give Collins credit, he just picked up 98 yards in a span of 35 seconds on two perfectly thrown deep balls.
38-yard toss to Wright, 60 yards on the next one to Edwards. Two plays, 98 yards, like you described it. The extra point off the upright. It hit the post and is no good. So Delaware still leads. But what a drive by Maine. Going two plays, 98 yards, four plays total. But Delaware leads it 7-6. That's your PNC Bank timeout score here on WDSD.
Come experience a new direction in healthcare. Star Health of the University
Welcome.
Of Delaware.
How are you doing?
Thanks for coming. Today you're going to choose a mobile office to drive to a remote work site.
Okay.
You can choose this Chevy Silverado that offers built-in 4G LTE Wi-Fi, or you can choose this Ford F-150 that doesn't offer Wi-Fi. But to make up for it, we added a trailer, a satellite antenna, and Dolores.
Hey, fellas.
Technology's a little behind in here.
Now, the Silverado offers built-in Wi-Fi with a connection that's stronger than your smartphone.
Slick.
So which one do you want?
I'd pick the Chevy.
Silverado.
It leaves Ford in the dust.
It just can't beat it.
And a goal. It's Delgado with his second.
Delaware 3.
1, 2, 3.
Delaware!
Looks like the shot, and that one's in as well. Stadium, 13:44, second quarter action, and Maine looked like they were going to be in a position where they'd have to punt it away to Delaware, give them great field position. But on third down, Dan Collins finds his target, Micah Wright, for 38 yards out to the Delaware 40, and the very next play, a 60-yard toss for a touchdown. So just like that, after a missed extra point, it's 7-6, Delaware on top.
You know, you understand the first one, you got caught in a blitz, they picked it up a tad, and then Collins just made a perfect throw. I mean, Watson's a half step behind. The second one is a little confusing because he runs up the seam, and if you're in cover two up the seam, the safety should be there. You shouldn't have anybody behind you, and instead he was completely behind the defense, and there was nobody over on that side. Very, very disappointing.
So the up man will take it for Delaware. It's Buck Jones at the 30 to the 35, spinning across the 35, and down he goes at the 36-yard line. So Delaware is a pretty good field position to start this drive.
A little surprising. Maine doesn't have much in the numbers that would suggest that they have struggled in terms of covering kicks. As a matter of fact, they've had a lot of success covering kicks over the course of this season, number-wise. And then when you look at what you're dealing with from the Delaware return game, it hasn't been all that potent. So to go to the sky kick there to try to play field position, it seems like you kind of did that to yourself that time and give Delaware a reasonably short field.
Delaware will start this drive at the 36-yard line, up by one, 13:39 remaining in the second quarter, and Walker will go play action. He's hit as he throws. Wes Hills trying to block the blitzer, and Walker's pass is incomplete as Sheffield got through.
Got to be able to pick up that blitz, and Delaware's got some problems in pass protection right now, doing a fantastic job in terms of the run blocking. And again, that's two straight series first down throws. I'd like to see Delaware be more balanced offensively as well. I think long term they have to do it, but as good as they ran the ball on that first drive and for most of that second drive, surprised they've gotten aggressive the way they have with the play calling here these last couple of sets.
Walker will go back in shotgun form. His feet at the 30 on second down and 10 from the 36-yard line. Second and 10, and it's Wes Hills who gets bottled up at the line of scrimmage. Now third down and long.
Right down by three, Darius Hart.
As Darius Hart made the stop, the junior from Toms River, New Jersey.
Yeah, Hart makes the tackle. I think Mitchell made the play that time. Mitchell was able to shed the block, bounce to the outside, and get physical and kind of force him right back into the teeth of the defense. And, you know, Hills, his specialty is sprinting wide and just was unfortunately unable to do it there.
Third down and nine for Delaware. 13 minutes, second quarter action. Hens up by one, 7-6. Ball at the 37-yard line as Walker stands in shotgun form. Two wide receivers to the right side. One to the left is Jarman. Here's Walker. Pressure coming. Screen dropped by Wes Hills. He might have had a chance to run for that first down as he dropped it at the 36. That was the original line of scrimmage.
It's not a perfect throw by Joe, but it's a ball you got to be able to grab if you're Wes Hills. Hills, when he got injured last year, remember, he hurt his foot. One of the things he really worked hard on during the offseason was becoming better with his hands. He was going to be a better catcher of the ball, and the coaching staff was really happy with what they saw during spring practice and during summer camp. But unfortunately, we haven't seen it really come to fruition in games yet, and that was a big drop.
So now Will Stevenson will punt it again. A 48-yard punt his first time, and now Michael Wright to return the football, his feet back at the 20, waving for a fair catch as he backpedals to the 11-yard line. Micah Wright will make possession for the Bears after a 51-yard punt by Will Stevenson, his fourth, over 50 yards on the year. And at 12:39 remaining in the second quarter, now Maine a chance if they can do what they did last time they had the football to take their first lead.
Well, now if you're the Hens, you're just a tad slower in terms of how aggressive you're going to get here. Try to play downhill Delaware defensively against the run because the Black Bears were able to get aggressive with the play calling. Will they have a little bit more space to run the football? Will it open up some options on the ground? That's the, kind of the interesting thing. That's the back and forth that you're hoping will go your way here if you're Maine. Or do you trust your quarterback that he's hot right now? Collins made two perfect throws.
Here's Collins, and the give is to, now he's going to keep it and throw on the far side of the field, caught at the 19-yard line. And again, that's Micah Wright.
By the way, I want to give you some credit. We're having some technical difficulties due to the rain with the parabolic mic down there. That is a fantastic job by you to call the game. And as you're doing that, go to the back bag and get the mic out. That's the reason you hear that crackling. But he didn't miss a step, folks. That's pretty well done by Scott Klatska.
It's all that goes on behind the scenes. So we should have some sound now for you at 12:05. Thank you, Maddie. I appreciate that. And now back, I can pay attention to the ball game now as Maine hands it off to their back at the 22-yard line, 11:56 to go, and a tackle made by Malcolm Brown here in the second quarter.
Just that persistent, slow drizzle, that kind of that soaking rain. But give Maine credit. You know, you would wonder, will it affect the passing game? It has not for the Black Bears. Now, Collins on that first down throw, he missed one. That passes up a little bit, probably goes for 15, 20 yards because it's one-on-one on the edge and with some space for Owens to make a play. But because it was low, he had to go down, cradle it. Give him credit for making the catch, and now Maine's back in business.
First down and 10, ball at the 22-yard line of Maine. They'll go play action. Collins rolling out, has some room to run, and he will. He realizes that he gets to 25, cuts it up there at the 30, and he'll have second down at about one as Bell and Reeder were both there, but a good run by quarterback Collins.
And both of these passes here on this initial drive have been naked boots rolling out to the right with only one receiver on that side of the field with them, and then they're trying to slip something deep down the center. But give Collins credit that time, Good coverage by the Delaware secondary. It looked like Torza jumped the route, but Collins had some space to cut back against the grain and then get down to avoid a big hit.
Second down and one. As the tight end goes in motion, play action again. Collins with pressure, gets it off. Looking for Osuma, it's off his chest. He had to turn around to get it at the 30. That was good defense that time by Tenny Adewusi, but Dan Collins has been on target this ball game.
Yeah, that was good recovery by Adewusi. That was the first throw that he missed it by just a hair. If he just lifts that ball high in the air and lets his receiver run underneath of it, might be a touchdown. At least it's a big play. He didn't quite get that one far enough out, kind of spun the receiver around. That gave Adewusi the extra step to recover, but you have to give him credit because it would have been very easy for him to kind of lose track of the play and interfere. Instead, played the ball very effectively, found it in the air.
Tight end in motion on third down and one. They'll give it to the running back, Beckford, hit by Jackson. Bilal Nichols got to him but wasn't in time. It looked like they got the yard that they needed out to the 32 to extend the drive.
They did exactly what they wanted. They got to the edge. They forced it back to the center of the defense, and the line held up pretty well. But as we talked about with Wes Hills, that ability to stop, change directions, and then dart forward, Maine did it there. And hey, when you only need a yard, it's a lot easier to execute.
Delaware leads 7-6, 10-31, and ticking in the second quarter. Trips to the left side for Collins, the quarterback. He's had a good day thus far, and they'll give it instead to the running back, Zaire Williams, the transfer from Temple, converted linebacker. He gets to the 37-yard line before Nichols makes the tackle.
And a little chippy on the outside that time, a little pushing, a little shoving after the play, a little frustration from the Delaware defense, and maybe Maine getting some confidence and getting some swagger. You got to be careful if you're both sides there. You don't want to give up 15 yards. This is the type of the game where a 15-yard penalty with both of these offenses probably proves lethal to a drive.
Collins at the quarterback position, second down and six for him. Ball in the 37, and again, they'll go to Williams. Williams, all blue all day to that left side. That's all he saw ahead of him as he tried to turn the corner but could not. Tackled back for a loss at the 35.
You're not going to run laterally, stringing plays out against this Delaware team. They're just too fast to the football. Maybe JMU can get away with it because of their just pure speed. Maine doesn't have that type of speed. The linebackers are going to go chase it down, and then everybody else flows to the football. It's got to be north and south. Way too much east and west trying to run the ball in the early going from me.
Trips to the right on third down and eight, 9:19. Second quarter, Collins pumps, sets, fires. A nice catch by Michael Wright away from his body. It's going to be just shy of the first down marker, though, as Justin Watson was there in coverage. Great grab to come back to get it from Wright, the sophomore. But it's going to be shy of a first down. It was third and eight.
Because he had to come back, that's the reason it's not a first down. He had no momentum, no really center of balance underneath of him, and the hit knocked him back right away. Maine's coaching staff did not like the spot, but I think they got it dead on, about a foot and a half shy, and Maine's going to roll the dice.
Joe Harris-Simiak, the head coach of Maine, turned 30 in June. Youngest coach in all of college football Division I, has a decision on his hands here. It's fourth and one, and a yard to go, a little less than a yard to go, and it looks like
they're going to take a timeout.
The man I just mentioned going to use a timeout here.
Kind of like what you see from Delaware often. Shorten the game. Run that clock. Give yourself some extra time to think about what might be the decision of the game.
So Joe Harris-Simiak will talk things over. 8:23 remaining in the second quarter. The Hens up 7-6.
And I didn't mean to step on you there personally. I'd punt the football here if I'm Maine.
I mean, think so too.
I understand that you're a physical football team and you want to assert yourself a little bit here. I understand it's a foot and a half, but you're down a point. You've played really well after a shaky start, and Delaware's offense hasn't done much its last couple of possessions. Why jumpstart it with a short field? I mean, we heard Dave Brock talk about last season, one of the problems for his defense was people didn't fear his offense, so if they pick up a third down, they'd stay on the field fourth down. Maybe a similar line of thinking here from Maine, but where you are on the field, it just doesn't seem like it's a good risk. I think it's better 50-50 chance you pick up the first down, but you still have a long field in front of you to go get points if you pick it up, and if you give Delaware a short field, you're in a world of hurt.
We'll see what Maine comes out of the huddle with as the timeout about to expire, and Maine offense on the field. Dan Collins is the quarterback with the ball on his own 42. I formation. The running back, Darian Davis Bay. I form, tight end in motion. Here's the fourth and one play. Collins rolls out. He's going to run for it, and he's going to get it. Malcolm Ooh. Brown gave him a smack as he went to the sideline, and that's going to be a penalty on Brown.
Is that going to be a targeting? Because he was not out of bounds. That's a clean hit, but are they going to say he speared him?
Remember, Malcolm Brown was ejected from the game at Lafayette a few weeks back.
If they're saying out of bounds, that's a joke.
Personal foul. Laid it out of bounds. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
Boy, we're all the way across the field. It sure looked like, he tried to take an angle towards the first down. The hit came while his foot was still on this side of the boundary. We see the replay up here on the big screen as he gets to the first down marker. That's not out of bounds. Come on, he starts to hit. He's headed for a first down. You've got to let him play. If you want to protect the quarterback, he's got to go on a straight line out of bounds. He can't try to angle up the field on a fourth down where you're trying to keep your offense on. I understand protecting players and safety is an important thing, but if a quarterback wants to protect himself, he's got to protect himself. There are rules set up. He can slide. He can go straight out of bounds there and not take that hit. If he wants to angle it up to make sure that he gets that first down, then Malcolm Brown has every right to come up and get that hit. As long as contact makes while he's still in bounds, it sure looked like from our angle that's what it was. And that's a bad call that goes against the hit.
Tough break for Delaware as Malcolm Brown called for the personal foul, his second of the season. And now it's first and 10 in Delaware territory at the 41 for Collins in shotgun form. He's dropping back, throwing again, this time to Wright, and Wright was under it, but his outstretched arms couldn't haul it in at the 3. So, an incomplete pass is thrown.
Hens are getting caught flat-footed right now, and Maine receivers are just running by them left and right, and that's got to be something that is addressed right now if you're the Hens, because it is alarming how many steps you're seeing these wide receivers get. And this is a Maine team that we said in the pregame show, they're not a high-percentage passing team, but they'll take some shots vertically, and that's how they're able to survive through the air. And, that was a good throw. That should have been a touchdown.
Split backs now for Maine, second and 10. And they'll go to Williams. Williams working his way to the right side, gang tackled there at the line of scrimmage at the 41. So it's going to be third down and 10 for Maine, 7:41, second quarter. Delaware up 7-6. Dan Collins, 9 of 13 today for 134 and a touchdown.
9 of 13 with at least two, if not three, drops already here in the early going. He has been spot on, but he is also throwing to pretty wide open targets. And if you're Delaware's defense, be aware that if they get 5-6 yards, they're probably going to go for it here. So it's not necessarily just a win if you get them to 6 or 7.
Third down and 10. Trips to the left side for Collins in shotgun form. Dan Collins looking, throwing, and another drop. Jaleel Reed was open at around the 37-yard line with possible room to run for a first down. And he took his eye off the ball as he came across.
Well, Hens kind of trying to set up an umbrella defense at the first down marker. Nobody got wide to the numbers. That was going to be a shallow cross, but he had space. He was going to get to the sideline. I think he would have picked up that first down with ease, probably with a couple yards to spare. Another big drop for Maine. The Hens have to thank the Black Bears right now. They are very fortunate to still be leading this game.
So it's fourth down and 10, and the punter is on for Maine. That one's high, and it's going to bounce. Maine is under it before it bounces. What a play by Ertis Edwards at the one-yard line, a 40-yard punt. And Delaware will start at their own one-yard line with 6:57. We'll take a break with 6:57 left in the second quarter. Your PNC Bank timeout score, Delaware 7, Maine 6.
Star Health at the University of Delaware offers comprehensive...
They end 2015 with a road victory over Elon.
Our season ended at 2:55. At 2:56, a new season began. But we can't just talk about it. We've got to be about it. On the field, no one's spot is guaranteed. And in here, excuses don't matter. I'm going to work harder and longer than I ever have. Check your feelings at the door, because the bar has been raised.
Hello, Delaware fans. This is Coach Brock at beautiful Lums Pond State Park, just minutes from Delaware Stadium. I'm inviting you to come to the park, enjoy their year-round camping, boat rentals, equestrian center, and so much more. While you're here, experience the Go Ape Treetop Adventure. Go Ape is an outdoor experience where you can live life adventurously and experience the park from 50 feet up in the trees, hanging by a wire. To learn more about Go Ape or to book your visit to the course, visit www.goape.com. Go Hens!
Falls down here in Newark. The Hens get a stop on defense, but they've got 99 yards to go on this drive. It'll start with 6:57 remaining in quarter number two and a 7-6 lead.
They were able to dodge a bullet. Should have been a touchdown on a long throw towards the end zone that was dropped. Could have had another 30, 40 yarder that was bobbled and dropped a little underthrown by Collins. And then a first down throw on third and 10 that was dropped. But now you're backed up. I think you got to go back to trying to play downhill, run the football here.
Jefferson is the running back. His feet in his own end zone. Walker lobs one, looking for Scarf. Scarf can't run under it as it falls incomplete at the 32-yard line.
I like that they're trying to take the shots. I know I just said play downhill football. I like the idea. I like the spirit. It's just they're not getting any separation. There's nobody open. We're looking across the field. The last drive, they had the three-man route. Three men completely blanketed. That time they try the shot. They quick toss, lob on one-on-one coverage. Scarf gets no separation whatsoever, so Walker tries to float it, see if maybe he can make something happen, and Scarf just couldn't go run it down.
Joe, 1 of 6 today, no yards, and now he's got his feet in the end zone, waiting for the snap on second down. It goes to Jefferson. Jefferson has a hold of the 5, runs into a Maine defender at the 7-yard line, but some space to work as third down approaches, the tackle made by Jason Matova.
And again, turned a 2nd and 10 into a 3rd and short here. 3rd and 4, and I would not at all be surprised if Delaware does not try to run this ball for the first down. I am a little surprised to not see Wes Hills on the field here. This is such a pivotal possession. Not that Thomas Jefferson isn't a really talented player, but we talked about it. You know, Hills is your calling card. Hills is your potential All-American. He's the guy that was unstoppable on that initial drive.
It is Jefferson as the single back on 3rd down and 4 from the Delaware 7-yard line. Walker talking to his offensive line, pointing and directing from that quarterback position. They'll go to Thomas Jefferson, who's hit in the backfield. As soon as he got the handoff, it was Darius Green who was there. The tackle for loss, his 4th on the season. The blitz by Maine pays off, and the Hens will have to punt out of their own end zone.
Caught Delaware trying to pull and give Green credit. He just shot the gap right between the guard and a tackle trying to get wide. He almost took that football away from Walker on the handoff. I mean, Jefferson barely had it secured, and Green's all over him. It didn't matter who was back there that time. He had no shot whatsoever.
Maine's going to get the ball back in good field position. Micah Wright stands at the Delaware 42-yard line awaiting Will Stevenson's punt. He's in the back of the end zone, catches it cleanly, gets it off. It's a good one, sending right backwards to the 49. He gets to the 45-40 into Delaware traffic at the 40-yard line. And that's where Maine will start their drive. Tackle made by Jalen Randolph. A 46-yard punt, a 9-yard return for Micah Wright with 5:11 remaining in the second quarter. Delaware leads 7-6 as the Hens get a sideline warning. Their first.
Short field here for Maine. The game has been shortened by the run-first offense for both of these clubs, or the high-percentage pass offense that we've seen from Maine. And if you're Delaware, you know, your offense has not done you any favors here in terms of the field position. Got to find a way to hold them to 3 here. The good news for the Hens, running out of time, they get the football to start the second half. That's where the defer comes in handy, that decision from Dave Brock earlier. So if you could hold them to 3, that would be very beneficial.
1st and 10 play goes to Josh Mack. Haven't seen much from him since the first series, his first carry in quite some time. Doesn't go for much to the 39-yard line of Delaware, a pickup of 1.
You know, they're not having much success running the football. And when I say not much success, virtually none. I mean, 21 yards to the ground right now. But what they're trying to do is they're trying to keep that defensive line honest. So when they do go back to the passing game, A, play action can be effective. B, more importantly, you don't have 4 guys with their ears pinned back just sprinting after Collins. Give them some time to set up those vertical routes.
On second down and nine, Reed goes in motion. They fake the handoff to him, set up the screen. Matt catches it at the 40-yard line with room to run at the 30. Nichols giving chase at the 20. Down the sideline, 10. And Adderley pushes Mack, but Mack dives in. Ooh. Stopped at the 1. They'll stop him at the 1-yard line. Josh Mack, nearly a score. He's 3 feet out after a 38-yard screen pass to success by the Black Bears.
Oh, the Hens got in there so quick trying to blow that screen up, and that is a fantastic play by Collins. He had to get back in a hurry after they faked the jet sweep, and just a really tough angle, a little lob over the top. It's kind of a blind pass, and see a lot of quarterbacks struggle with that one. That should have been a touchdown. That was a bad spot.
From the one, can Maine take their first lead? Collins, play action, wide open is his tight end. And it's a touchdown for the Maine Black Bears. They take their first lead, Michael Supp, with the touchdown.
Another boot. We've seen them use it to their advantage at least three or four times. Collins faking to the back, rolling with no one on the backside to block, but nobody there chasing him. It's just an easy throw. Nobody in his face and nobody covering Zach. And just discouraging right now how many guys are running wide open for the Hens or against the Hens.
Supp, a defensive lineman. They brought him in for that goal line set. That's his first offensive play of the season, and he gets a touchdown.
And you understand why maybe you'd lose track of him, but they've been running boot. You think that would be something that'd be in your head, and now they're going to get tricky. And the Hens just caught a huge break. Oh, man, is Maine going to be mad. The officials put the ball in for play. Maine split their formation. They were going to run one of those trickery where they had two guys in the center of the field, and the officials didn't have the clock set.
Wow. Joe Harris-Simiak sprinted down the field to yell at the officials and give them an earful, as they deserved on that play, messing up what could have been a sneaky two-point conversion for Maine. Remember, Maine missed that first PAT, so they have 12 points now to Delaware 7.
Well, you asked for the clock to get adjusted. It didn't get adjusted, and then you blew it in for play. Now they're going to go ahead and do it again, but the Hens saw it.
Swinging gate now as Collins talking to his teammates.
It's not there.
Now they'll get back into formation to kick the extra point. Still plenty of time on the clock. It's 10, now at 8. So Maine trying to get tricky, but you're right. Delaware saw it the first time, wasn't there, and they put the PAT through. So your PNC Bank timeout score, Maine 13, Delaware 7, 3:58, second quarter.
There are over 3,000 lawyers in Delaware today.
Little details, truly the game of inches. Small things people don't see. It's about putting yourself in the best position. It starts here. The work isn't flashy. It's not glamorous, but it's necessary. Because after all, the future is now.
Hello.
Nice to meet you.
Welcome, welcome.
Today I'm going to show you the all-new 2016 Chevy Cruze and ask you what you think. But here's the catch. You can only answer in emojis. What emoji would you use to describe the design?
I think it's sexy.
It has available built-in 4G LTE Wi-Fi.
Rock on. That's excellent. We got Wi-Fi.
This car gets an EPA estimated 40 miles per gallon highway.
This car is like a unicorn. It's magical.
Because Maine has taken a first half lead after a three-play 40-yard drive that ends with a touchdown from Michael Supp. And now Delaware getting the football back at the 20-yard line, 25-30. It's Ray Jones getting out to the 30-yard line, where Delaware's offense will get back onto the field, down for the first time today. 3:53 remaining, quarter number two.
Hens have no passing yards right now. 3:53 on the clock. They do have three timeouts, but they're not built for two-minute offense. Good news is it's four-minute offense they have to execute here. But right now, more than anything else, they just need to pick up a first down. It looks eerily similar to last week, where they came out gangbusters offensively. First two drives, one scoring, one they moved the football, just couldn't put points on the board. Absolutely nothing since.
Wes Hills is the single back as Delaware starts this drive with Walker under center and two wide receivers. He'll go to Wes Hills, running strong and diving across the 35 to the 38. An 8-yard pickup on first down for Wes Hills. And when I say diving, I mean literally dive. I mean, he will lunge his body forward to pick up a couple extra yards each time.
And you admire it about the kid. It just worries you a little bit because he's so important to this offense. You need him to stay healthy and stay out there. And each of the last two seasons, he's suffered some major injuries. Unbelievable that he was able to come back from that elbow injury as quickly as he did. And that's why probably they're trying to limit his carries, but you need him out there right now.
He's got 8 carries, 60 yards now, along with 18. Second down and 2, and they'll go back to Hills. This time a big hole, 45, midfield, Maine territory down at the 46-yard line. Wes Hills with a 16-yard carry, moving the football and the chain.
I mean, he's just different. Yes, the blocking's a little bit better here, and again, I'm not trying to disparage Randolph or Jefferson. They're both really good backs, but when your offensive line is off just a tad and you're one-dimensional offensively right now and everybody's teeing off against the run, Wes Hills is that guy that can beat the defense almost by himself. And I mean, he's got to take a blow here after a couple of big hits, but he's just a difference maker out there when he's on the field.
Scarf in the ball game in the slot, right side. 3 wide receivers, and they'll throw reverse. It's Gallon to the 45-40. Tackle made by Uchenna Agwanwu. And we see Troy Gallon, who has 1 reception on the season and a drop pass last week, get into the mix. He's a speedster, but he's had some injuries throughout his career, now a redshirt sophomore.
Trying to get him the ball in space. They really are looking to try to get Gallon involved because they think he's a difference maker in terms of pure athletic talent, even in spite of all the injuries he's suffered.
It's second down and 4, ball at the main 40-yard line with Walker under center and the single back, Wes Hills. 2 minutes even remaining in the second quarter. Wes Hills dropped the football, got it back. It actually be a pickup of 3 yards, a dangerous play, scary play for Delaware. What's scarier is the size of the hole that Wes Hills had. I don't know if he got excited and just dropped the football, but that could have been a big gain for Hills if he didn't bobble it before falling back on top.
Yeah, ball security is an issue. He never had a clean handle on that exchange from Walker. He almost took out poor Pepe there as he fell into the back of his legs to recover. He had no choice but to do it. Hens got to pick up the pace here a little bit. I know they have 3 timeouts, but they're not a passing offense. So a long way to go if they want to put this in the end zone.
It's 3rd down and 2 here from the main 38-yard line. After the fumble recovery by Hills, trips to the right side. Walker again to Hills. Hills picks it up, breaks a tackle, 25, spinning, still on his feet, inside the 20, and a first down run by Wes Hills of 20 yards. Get the Hens inside the red zone.
Are you kidding me?
Wow.
He gets hit at the line of scrimmage and spins off. Then he breaks a leg tackle. Then he goes down the field, spins through 3 different defenders with 2 pirouettes, and somehow stays on his feet and goes for an extra 5 yards. That's freak of nature stuff right there from Wes Hill.
Unbelievable. He's got 11 carries, 99 yards now. Under a minute, first half. Hens down 13-7. Hills again. Starts left, cuts it to the right at the 10. Wes Hills is going to score from 17 yards out, and the Blue Hens retake the lead.
Scott, we talked about it. They brought pressure from the corner that time about not trying to do too much. Corner came up, and he's the only defender on that side. And his Hills, with his specialty of just bouncing runs to the outside and accelerating in the blink of an eye, once the corner came up and over-pursued the play, there's nobody left on that side. So all it is Hills has to beat the defense to the edge. You like your chances with Wes Hills doing that. The corner really hurt himself getting as far up the field as he did that time.
Frank Rago on for the extra point. I was a little early on my call, Matt. This is to retake the lead, and Rago does just that. Delaware up 14-13, 42 seconds left in quarter number 2. We'll be back in a moment. That's your PNC Bank timeout score on 94.7 WDSD.
Kirkwood Dental, where smiles never end.
Want more Delaware Athletics content? Click around here on Hens All Access for live games, game highlights, features, and more. And follow your favorite Hens on Twitter for the latest updates.
It's your turn to mix it up at Mickey D's. For a limited time, choose any 2. From mouth-watering new picks to tasty classics. McPick 2 for $5. Enjoy the choice.
rush hour, or relax hour. It's your choice. Ride more, save more, do more. Dart, moving forward.
Yards and the Hens are on top again, 14-13. Roth kicks this one away and it's returned by Scott at the 15-yard line, sprinting at the 20, runs into a teammate at the 25, now 30. Adderley with the tackle at the 32-yard line. Back out on offense with 35 ticks left.
How aggressive do you want to get here if you're Maine? You've had success throwing the ball vertically down the field. The conditions have lightened up in terms of the rain here over the last couple of minutes. If I'm, man, I'm going aggressive here. I'm taking a couple of shots down the field, but I'm telling Connors, don't force anything. And make sure if you have pressure, get rid of the football. Intentional grounding wouldn't be the end of the world here if you're Maine. You're taking shots vertically, seeing if you can make something happen. That would be at least my MO here in this spot.
Collins will start in shotgun form, first and 10 from his own 32 with trips to the left side. He's going to run, climb the pocket, stands behind the line of scrimmage, and goes for it all down the field, and another drop pass at the 15-yard line. It was Adderley and Ernest Edwards battling for it way down the football field. Check that, Marquise Adams, and Adams had a just got his hands up there late.
Well, one of the reasons he got his hands up late, he was busy shoving Adderley to the ground, but it doesn't change the fact that Collins underthrew that football and another Maine receiver is behind the Delaware secondary. They have got to find a way to keep depth right now and to run with these receivers. They're letting guys get back. It also would help if they could land on Collins. He's got too much time to get the ball down the field.
Collins 11 of 17 for 173. He spins, rolls out of the pocket on second and 10. Plenty of time to throw, does so again to right. Down the sideline, Teddy Adelucci picks it off.
Much better job by Delaware defensively that time because Collins rolls out and had time. Tough for a right-hander to roll left like that and throw the ball down the field. He had to try to stop, set his feet. By the time he did, Adewuzi had gotten back, and Collins just couldn't really put that ball up. It's a one-on-one. You're hoping your receiver can go get it. The interception doesn't hurt him there. I mean, you're figuring you're taking your shot and trying to get points. If you don't, then Delaware's going to take a knee. But it's a good play on the ball by Adewuzi because if the receiver goes and gets that, Maine takes the lead at the half. So something to build on in the secondary there in the locker room. But they have some adjustments to make.
You're right, though. What it does is it prevents at least another score, and you can take some momentum into the locker room as Adewuzi picks off Collins. Collins' seventh interception of the season. And for Adewuzi, his second INT of the year. That's going to do it for the first half of action as Walker takes a knee and both teams will head to their locker rooms. Before we do go to the locker room, we'll talk with head coach Dave Brock as he makes his way to Michael Atrasen. That interview presented by Rufo Associates. Visit RufoLaw.com. And Michael Atrasen is waiting for head coach Brock to get to him.
To disengage in his furious conversation with the official. He's got a point. Again, it was a blatant push off they missed that the receiver dropped the ball. Could have been the difference of a touchdown. So I understand why Brock's so upset.
And now Mike is with Dave Brock on the field.
How you doing, Coach? Offense came out firing, then we got into a little stagnant period of time, and then we seemed to pick up late in the second half. What's going on with the offense in terms of running the ball? Are we staying on game plan?
Yeah, we just got to hammer the ball at them, and we get some chances to throw some play-action shots. We got to throw them. We blew two protections and dropped the screen. That would have been a huge play. You know, and we just got to keep hammering. We're running the ball as well as we've run it all year, so I feel good about that. Defensively, we're getting beat on some naked, some bootlegs, things like that. The quarterback has too much time. He's on the perimeter a little too much. And then we've been, you know, non-competitive on a couple passes. But we'll get that fixed at halftime. We've got to come out. And I don't think they can run it. So now we got to shut the pass down.
All right, Coach. So what are you telling your team right here at halftime?
Right, 1-point game. We got to go get it. I mean, another 30 minutes. The best football we played all year. We need to play it fast and physical. Run the ball and go get that quarterback.
All right. Thank you, Coach.
All right. Thank you, Mike. 1 point game at the half. It's our Blue Hens halftime report presented by the International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, Local 313, and it's local contractors. When we come back, Marty Sheehan is in the WDSD studios. He'll have scores from around college football and the Blue Hens in other sports. 14-3, that's your PNC Bank timeout score as we head to the half on WDSD.
Okay, this is it, guys.
From the beautiful Delaware coastline to the busy streets of Maine, it's easy to see that even within our 96 miles, Delaware has a wide variety of people. That's why when you're looking for great rates on insurance, you should trust the local agent. Ann Sharp from your GEICO local office knows Delaware. And that's why when you need insurance, you can trust Ann and her team of professionals. Call Ann Sharp at your GEICO local office Delaware today for a quote.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Under the Lights, driven by Chevy here on BlueHens.com. I'm Scott Klatskin with head coach Dave Brock. And, coach, going to talk about the game down in Harrisonburg, Virginia today against James Madison, a rivalry game. It was the first game in conference play, and it was against the seventh-ranked team in the country, a very, very solid football team. We talked last week about it was going to be a tough matchup. It was going to be a tough ball game, but certainly didn't think it was going to get to the score that it got to, a 43-20 loss against the Dukes. What happened? How did it get out of hand?
Well, first, we didn't play very well. And I think you got to give credit to James Madison. They are a good team and a lot of good players, well coached. But we just didn't handle the game very well. You know, we went back and forth in the first quarter. Both of us, you know, had opportunities to score on our first possession, missed a field goal. They scored a touchdown. We really put together one of the best drives we've had all year. And tied the game at 7, about whatever there was, 12 minutes left in the second quarter. You feel like, you know, it's the game's in a good place. We got to tighten the things up on defense because we'd given up two drives. And when they scored again to give up the third drive, you know, offensively, we really needed to either score an answer or possess the ball and kind of give the defensive coaches and kids a chance to decompress a little bit and make some adjustments. And we just didn't handle that second quarter well. You know, we went 3 and out two times in a row, and they answered both 3 and outs with touchdowns, and the momentum got away from you. So we got to do a better job of making sure if we're in that situation again, you keep the game, you know, under control where it needs to be, and we know we're getting the ball to start the second half. You got to get it to halftime, you know, as a two score game, and then you come out and you have a chance to play that 30 minutes the way you need to play it. But very disappointing in terms of our performance, and we're certainly capable of playing a lot better, and that's what we'll have to do this week against Maine.
This is a team that we've talked about is built on, and most of your teams have built on, stopping the run. You want to run the football and stop the run, and against James Madison to allow almost 400 yards rushing, I know it was a disappointment for you and the team, but so many missed tackles this week against James Madison. What were you seeing out there that was happening?
Well, again, it's something that hasn't happened. So it's hard to, you know, it's really hard to look at it in the game and have a solution for what really amounts to a physical problem. There's things schematically that go into it in terms of closing space and playing fast and physical. I think they did a good job of creating some one-on-ones, and they won those one-on-ones the majority of the time. We were in and out of some gaps that we needed. You know, we were out of gaps we needed to be in. We didn't get in gaps we needed to be in. And that reduced the effectiveness of our linebackers at times. And then they had a couple 50-50 balls in down the field, and they made all of them. So, again, credit to them. But we're capable of playing much, much better defensively than we played on Saturday. And we certainly need to if we're going to be the team we want to be.
On the offensive side of the ball, you guys ran for 312 yards yourself, the big three when you look at Thomas Jefferson and Wes Hills and Jalen Randolph, averaged over 9.5 yards per carry when you look at their carries. Why did that not turn into more points, do you think, when you're able to run the ball so effectively?
Well, I think, again, I think it's one of the fallacies about statistics at time. They can be very misleading. You know, when we needed to run the football, was the fourth possession of the game, the second quarter when it's 14-7, you know, you got to be able to run the ball. You got to be able to possess the ball, gain first downs, hopefully score, but at least flip the field and eat up the clock and create less opportunities for them. You know, sometimes playing great defense is playing less defense. And, you know, that was something we did a lot last year. And you know, we need to be able to get back to that to a certain degree. And, you know, again, we weren't able to do it. I think to have a couple explosive runs, you know, towards the end of the game, you know, it certainly makes things look better than they were. And I don't think you can be unrealistic in terms of how you evaluate that. I mean, the statistics, but we didn't run the ball well enough when we needed to, certainly to affect the game.
I know we talk about Joe Walker and the quarterback and passing of Delaware almost every show, but a high for Joe Walker against James Madison, throwing the football, and he looked like he's starting to develop a pretty good relationship throwing the football with Deontay Cherry. Were you pleased at what you saw, some improvement in the passing game this week?
Well, again, statistically, you know, we felt like we'd have some X plays. We had it, you know, the second drive that resulted in the touchdown, first and 10. You know, the drive starter was a post corner to Deontay, really well thrown. Joe took a shot right in the face, you know, as he threw the ball. He got hit too many times. We had a number of protection issues that, again, we have not had over the course of the last year and a half, probably. We need to make sure we fix those. We need a clean pocket. We need, you know, clean opportunities. You know, we had Deontay probably 15 yards behind anybody on the field, and we missed a blitzer clean, and then he gets hit as he threw it, and the ball goes about 10 yards over Deontay's head. So we got to make sure that we shore up the protection, make the throws, and then, you know, we still had four drops in the game, which is, you know, when you only throw the ball 20 times, you know, you have to be more efficient in terms of whether or not it's good throws or catches or anything else. And then, you know, I think, again, the statistics would not only be more valuable, but they would be more pertinent.
Still a lot of football left. There's a whole season almost of conference play still available to get wins and, very winnable games the rest of the way if you play the way that you know you're capable of playing. What do you do this week to ensure the team gets back on track?
Well, I think you don't look at it that way. I really think you have a plan and you have a process and a schedule and you know, you talk about what we didn't do well, and you know, if we did things well, you talk about those things, you evaluate them, you make the corrections, you move on. Whether you win or lose, I think consistency is really one of the most important things over time to create success. And I think that's how you have to look at it. And you know, the one thing I talk to the players about, and I talk to the staff about, is making sure that we're in the right tense. You know, I think one of the things that happens in a situation like this, especially early in the year, is people talk about that there were high expectations or there was enthusiasm for the season or things like that. And you know, my answer to the players and to the staff and even to the fans is there are high expectations for the season and there is enthusiasm for the season. And you know, we're going to play well when we come in here and play Maine on Parents Day. And you know, that's how you approach it, in my opinion.
I'd love to hear that. We're going to talk about the Maine Black Bears who come into town on Saturday when we come back on Under the Lights, driven by Chevy.
They end 2015 with a road victory over Elon.
Our season ended at 255. At 256, a new season began. But we can't just talk about it. We've got to be about it. On the field, no one's spot is guaranteed. And in here, excuses don't matter. I'm going to work harder and longer than I ever have. Check your feelings at the door, because the bar has been raised.
We brought you here today to get your honest opinion about this new car. To keep things unbiased, we removed all the logos.
Feels like a BMW.
Reminds me a little bit of an Audi.
So this car supports Apple CarPlay.
Siri, open maps. Wow. She gets me.
It also has teen driver technology. It even mutes the radio until the seatbelts are buckled.
I'm very curious what it is.
This is the 2016 Chevy Malibu.
And it sells for?
It starts at
$22,500. What?
Oh, wow.
I mean, all this technology.
That's a game changer.
Welcome to another edition of Down and Back. I am Andrew Wickman, this time alongside Jalen Kindle. Jalen, we're going to take a look into your life. How does that sound?
Sounds great. Let's get started.
All right. First question. What does it mean coming up from Florida to play for Delaware?
It was a unique opportunity. Delaware just has so much to offer academically. From the moment I stepped on campus on my visit, just everybody made me feel like this was home for me. It was like a brotherhood. And to date, this is one of the closest teams I've ever been on. So just coming up here and just trying to create some success, it's just gonna be the best memories of my life. I know it.
So aside from football bringing you to Delaware, what else brought you to Delaware?
New coaching staff, Coach Brock, really seemed like a family-oriented guy. So I knew that was gonna translate into a player-oriented guy. And I knew he wasn't just about the business. He was really into creating men off the field, in the classroom, in the community, and stuff like that. So that was another big reason.
Cool. So your academics clearly mean a lot to you. You're an honor student. What does it take to manage both sides, both on and off the field?
You just have to get your priorities in order. School will always come first, and then your football responsibilities, and then if you have extra time from after that, which most of the time you don't, then you can get into video games and going out and doing other stuff. But you just got to get your priorities in order. You know that football is not going to last your whole life, so you got to focus on what matters, and that's getting your education, trying to decide what you're going to do after.
All right, so switching gears, you had two broken feet your freshman year. Mm-hmm. What kept you going through that hard time, and what still keeps you on the field today?
You know, that was that first injury coming out of high school. It was probably the hardest point of my life, but I don't know. I feel like it just made me into the person I am today. I know that's kind of cliche, but just knowing that if you can fight through something like that and not being able to walk for, 4 months, being confined to a wheelchair and a scooter, and you can pretty much get through anything, and it just developed my work ethic, trying to get back onto the playing field. I don't know. It was a good experience, good and bad, but like I said, it kind of made me into the person I am today, more refined.
All right, so taking a step back from the football field, up on campus, what's your favorite place to hang out or study?
Hang out. I mean, there's always people scattered throughout Chabant. Sit back in between classes, relax, joke around for a little bit, take your mind off school for a couple minutes. Study, go to the library, spend hours upon hours at the library. I was there last night until closing, 2:00, so.
And finally for you, heading towards the end of the season, what are your main goals to finish the season for you and for the team?
For me personally, just keep trying to contribute in any single way I can. At will, the weak side linebacker, special teams, and really just continue to develop the younger guys, bring them along. But as a team overall, we just want to finish the season strong. We have 8 straight conference games against quality opponents, so just trying to finish out with a win and hopefully make it to the playoffs and reach our goals of being a championship team. So
cool, man. Well, good luck to you. Thank you for stopping with us. Jalen Kindle stopping with us. That's been another Down and Back for Hens All Access. I am Andrew Wickman. We'll see you next time.
Little details. Truly a game of inches. Small things people don't see. It's about putting yourself in the best position. It starts here. The work isn't flashy, it's not glamorous, but it's necessary. Because after all, the future is now.
And a goal, it's Delgado with his second.
Welcome back to BlueHens.com here under the lights, driven by Chevy Scott Klatskin with head coach Dave Brock. And on Saturday, how about this? A home game for the Delaware Blue Hens. Like the sound of that. It's been a while. Maine comes to town, and it's the Maine Black Bears team that you saw while scouting for James Madison last week, because that was their first conference game. What does this Maine team bring to Delaware Stadium on Saturday?
Well, I think a pretty typical Maine team. I think they play really, really hard, and they got some very talented players on both sides of the ball, very well coached. And a resilient team. You know, you look at their schedule, they had to play two FBS teams out of the gate, lost both games. Certainly the Connecticut game was competitive to the end, and then they opened up at home with James Madison and certainly handled James Madison a little bit better than we did, and the game got away from them a little bit in the second half with some turnovers. Then they 0-3, and certainly in a tough spot. You know, Bryant came up to their place and had a lead in the second half, and all you saw was those guys kept their heads down and battled and grinded and believed, and you know, they found a way to win the game, and you know, I would anticipate that win will carry a huge amount of momentum over into this week and heading down here to Newark.
Yeah, you mentioned their first couple games of the season against FBS opponents, then James Madison, a top team in the country. You feel like it's a misleading 1-3 record? This is a team that's better than their record shows?
Yeah, I mean, I think your record is what it is, but they've played, three really good teams, and UConn and Toledo certainly going up a level. Really hard to win those games regardless. I know it happens sometimes, but it's hard. And then, James Madison is probably a top five team in the country. So they're 0-3. And the more impressive thing to me was, you have a chance in the second half where, you don't have a whole lot of momentum. You don't have a whole lot of things that went your way. And you keep your head down and you grind it out and you find a way to win a game late. And again, I think sometimes that's a spark plug to really, really good things. So we're anticipating a very confident group coming down here. We think they'll be, energy filled, and we think they're going to have a lot of momentum from winning that game and looking to do the same thing we're looking to do, which is get to 1-1 in conference play.
Now, offensively, this is a team with Dan Collins at the quarterback position and Michael Wright, who's a weapon. He was on pace to be certainly in the conversation for Rookie of the Year a season ago. They've got some weapons in the passing game, and they like to throw the football.
Yeah, very talented. It was interesting to watch them. When they're down in the game against Bryant, they're very patient. They're handing the ball. A young kid gained 130 yards, I think, 135 yards. And, it was interesting to see them kind of find their balance a little bit in that game. Maybe they were just trying to make sure they avoided one mistake. And they were able to do it, claw back into the game, scratch back into the game, and find a way to win it. But they're going to be very balanced. I think we'll have a better idea how they'll attack us when the game gets going, really. To see what they feel like our weakness is. And you look at the JMU game, you might think we can't stop the run. You just have to see, kind of how they see us defensively and what their plan of attack is. And then we have to be ready to go get it.
Defensively for them, they're led by Christoph Malumba Chamanga. I hope I don't have to say his name much on Saturday, but he leads the conference with 44 tackles on the season. He's not the only player on the team that's really a stellar player for that program. They've got good players at each position, or each level at least.
Each level of the defense. Starts up front with five. Richard, who's a really good player, very active, hard to block, and plays with, incredible, incredible energy. Obviously six, is an exceptional player. He's been a good player in the league for a long time. I think he's a former defensive rookie of the year years ago. And then number one, the corner, is another guy who, they'll lock him up, play man-to-man coverage and with him, and feel like they'll roll the dice and take their chances there. And the rest of the guys play really hard. They're very physical. They tackle. They close space. So it'll be a great challenge for us.
Maybe that's what I'll do. Number six. I'll just call him six.
Number six
if he makes the tackle. Now, their new head coach this year, Joe Harris-Simiak, is a young guy. I don't know if he was born when Jack Cosgrove took over the program for Maine. He turned 30 this year, did the head coach at Maine. But he's from the staff at Maine. Is there anything drastically different in a Joe Harris-Simiak coach team than you'll find with Cosgrove?
I don't think so. I think one of the advantages of him having been at Maine is he's probably got an understanding of what Coach Cosgrove built there and kind of what the tradition is there and the attitude. And I think, Jack had such great success. I think he's one of the most underappreciated coaches in college football in terms of what he did and how he was able to do it there. So I'm sure Joe understands, hey, this is we got the blueprint for success. And now we just got to make sure if we can make some improvements here and there and better it a little bit, we'll do it. But I think the foundation was there. And certainly it's a roster that's loaded with good players. So, Coach Cosgrove's never probably too far away. He's up there looking down on it, and then he's kind of the football czar up there now. So, I'm sure he's active and involved and really supporting Joe, which is, it's a neat thing, and it's good for him to have that.
Now, chance to get back to 500 in the early parts of conference play, parents and family weekend, a home game. How critical is it for this team to get a win on Saturday against Maine?
Yeah, every week's critical. I mean, certainly this one, coming off of the game we just played, you got to get back on the right track. You got to get to 1-1 in the conference, but approach wise, you take it as a one game season, and you really look and focus on the opponent. You focus on these matchups. You focus on the things that you're going to have to do well in this game. And if we do those things well, then I think we'll have a great chance, and it'll be a great day at Delaware Stadium.
All right, well, it's good to be back home, that's for sure.
Thanks, man.
All right, best of luck to you on Saturday against Maine. Tickets are still available at bluehens.com. It kicks off at 3:30. You won't want to miss it. A home game back at Delaware Stadium for conference play this time. Until then, for head coach Dave Brock, I'm Scott Kvatskin. Thanks for watching. This has been Under the Lights, driven by Chevy. And as always, go Hens.
From the beautiful Delaware coastline to the busy streets of Wilmington, it's easy to see that even within our 96 miles, Delaware has a wide variety of people. That's why when you're looking for great rates on insurance,
at every drive this game, pretty much those sky kicks, about a 5-yard return on average, and they get the football at the 30. So Delaware, remember, they won the toss, they deferred, they get the ball first here in the second half, and Joe Walker and Wes Hills in the offense back on the field.
Trying to bracket Maine. We've heard Dave Brock talk about that here over the past, that it's happened to Delaware a couple times. The Hens have an opportunity to kind of do it to the Black Bears. Remember, they scored on their last true possession of the first half, got the turnover, and then took a knee, and now they get the football, and guess who's out there at running back? He's been unstoppable when he's gotten the football in this game.
116 yards for Wes Hills. He's out there as the single back on first and 10, ball on the 32, tight end set, and here's Hills again. Stops his running movement towards the left, and he's brought down for a gain of about one. Pat Ricard was there, but even plays like that, Wes Hills, that should be a loss of one or two, and he gets to the line of scrimmage and makes it a gain of one. He has not been tackled behind the line of scrimmage this season.
I mean, that's crazy. The stop and start, the ability to let the defense flow past him, and then to avoid a big hit, too, because when you switch directions as many times as Hills does, you always have to watch that backside pursuit, and you get lit up. Hills seems to have eyes on the side and the back of his head to always know where it's coming. He did a good job just to dive forward and get something positive.
His 13th carry of the evening. As Joe Walker stands in shotgun form, second and nine, a 14-13 lead, and again to Wes Hills, and perhaps the first tackle for loss against Wes Hills this season, although I believe they'll give him back to the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, they did. He got popped, though. Great penetration that time. Darius Green, second time we've seen him kind of slip through as Delaware's trying to get out and pull the guard-tackle combination, and he's just, like, slipped his way through the gap. Quickness off the football. It's almost as though he has Delaware's snap count timed up right now, which is something to keep an eye on.
He was Maine's defensive lineman of the year a season ago, a very impressive player. He and Pat Ricard, the anchors of that defensive line. Now third down and nine, two carries to Wes Hills and only a yard to show for it to start this second half of action with a one-point lead, 14-13. 13-28 on the clock in the third, and Joe Walker drops back to throw. He has not had success throwing the football today. Gets away from a would-be sack, and now he's going to scramble at the 35, and he gets to the marker, I believe. That should be a first down scramble of 9 yards for Joe Walker using his legs.
That is fantastic play by Joe Walker. Hens have got to get this figured out, though, in pass protection that time. It's a four-man rush, and it got there. But give credit to Walker. Had his eyes down the field, felt the pressure as they ran a little stunt. The end came to the center, and Walker was able to move wide. And maybe Pepe, who started the game so strong, he doesn't seem like maybe he's 100% right now, and that little twist move, he couldn't run the guy down to make the block.
It's first and 10 after the third down conversion by Walker. Stretch play goes to Hills. He'll cut it, finds a hole at the 45, spins and lands at midfield. That's a 9.5-yard run by Wes Hills, brought down by DeAndre Scott. It'll be second down and short after Wes Hills continues his dominance.
You don't want to be, you know, guilty of hyperbole, but I mean, you can't understate the importance of that play from Walker to keep momentum on your side and just to keep this drive going. The last thing you could afford there was three and out to start this second half. And you looked like you were dead to rights to be in that spot. Walker made a play almost single-handedly to keep the offense out there.
Offset eye. Wes Hills still the back on second down and one for the Delaware 49-yard line. They give it to the steady hands of Wes Hills, and he gets the first down into Maine territory at the 47-yard line. Joshua Huffman, the sophomore, on the tackle.
That's a good play by Huffman just to get to the edge and set the block. And Wes Hills, a tough target to find. But again, Hills, you know, just kind of lowers his shoulder and finds his way forward. He took a big hit there. You'd like to see him not take helmets off the side of the knee like that. But just magnificent vision to just feel his way forward.
11:47, ticking 11:46. First and 10, ball on the 46. Maine territory this time. Maine's up by one. Excuse me, Delaware up by one. 14-13. Offset eye. Yoakum is the fullback. Hills still the running back. Hills with another carry. Shimmies his way to the 45-yard line.
Against 31 West Hills
to the 44-yard line. It looked like Sterling Sheffield was in on the tackle.
Not quite as much space here for Hills to operate so far on this drive. To his credit, he's made a couple of plays happen. Joe Walker had his backside to convert that big third and long. By the way, the Hens now 5 of 8 on third downs in this game, an area where they had really struggled coming into this contest. But they are really flooding the box and trying to stifle Delaware up near the line of scrimmage. I mean, they're playing zero high right now.
Cherry in the slot on second down and eight to the right side. Two wide receivers in that direction. Jarmie stands with them. Walker in shotgun form. And it'll be Hills running wide. And Ricard tracks him down at the 40-yard line. CAA Defensive Player of the Week makes his 23rd tackle of the season.
I mean, we talked about 8 men in the box. Expect to see that. It's 9 men in the box right now. There are zero safeties back. Hens have two wide receivers and a tight end out there. They are lined up on top of the tight end. Press coverage on the outside against the receivers. Everybody is up tight.
Hills is going to get a breather for the first time this half. 10:23 and ticking third quarter. As Randolph comes in, he'll stand next to Joe Walker. His feet at the 45-yard line in Maine territory. The ball at the 40 on third down and four. Matt mentioned the success the Delawares had on third down today. They're 5 of 8. Came in this week at 33%. So Randolph has it, trying to turn the corner at the 40. Does so. Flag is thrown at the 30. And down he goes inside the 25. But that should be a flag against Brandon Whaley.
It is. Whaley just completely lost his leverage. And he grabbed Kion Whitaker that time. And that's the only reason why Randolph got around the corner.
Offense, number 81, 10-yard penalty, still third down.
And Whaley knew it. I mean, there's really not much Whaley can do there. If he doesn't hold, they don't get the first down. Maybe it was two down territory. Maybe you'd like to see him, you know, not give the grab and see if Randolph can break the tackle. But he just got beat to the edge and lost complete leverage that time and had to hook and grab on for dear life.
Whaley, the all-CAA performer a season ago, third team as a tight end. Just his third game of the season. He's been injured a bit, but the penalty costly there. Third down and 12. Under 10 minutes now, third quarter. Delaware up 14-13. And the ball back at the Maine 48-yard line. So Walker in shotgun form. He's 1 of 6 today. Maine in the nickel. Randolph is the running back. Three wide receivers to the right side, one to the left. Walker looking right, throwing right, and it's too wide for Cherry, who had to dive for it at the 38-yard line. If he hauled it in, it would have been 2 yards shy of the first down marker. So Delaware gets the football first to start the second half, and they won't be able to put points on the board. We'll see Will Stevenson.
Would have went for it, though. If you bring that one in, it probably turns it into a four-down territory. Walsh had a little bit of pressure, but offensive line did a pretty good job. Cherry breaks open late to the outside, and it's a miss from Joe Walker that time. We haven't said that very much from him.
1 of 7 is his stat line today after a career-high 124 yards a week ago. Stevenson has it high. Wright will let it bounce. And Torza tiptoeing the end zone. Can't save it. He could have just thrown the ball over his head. He had possession of it, trying to tiptoe at the goal line. And he lost it. So it'll be Maine football for the first time in the second half when we come back. We'll take a break with 9:24 left in the third. Your PNC Bank timeout score, Delaware 14, Maine 13.
Mark your calendars now for the 60-second.
Little details. Truly a game of inches. Small things people don't see. It's about putting yourself in the best position. It starts here. The work isn't flashy. It's not glamorous, but it's necessary. Because after all, the future is now.
Hello.
Nice to meet you.
Welcome, welcome. Today I'm going to show you the all-new 2016 Chevy Cruze and ask you what you think. But here's the catch. You can only answer in emojis. What emoji would you use to describe the design?
I think it's sexy.
It has available built-in 4G LTE Wi-Fi.
Rock on, that's excellent, we got Wi-Fi.
This car gets an EPA estimated 40 miles per gallon highway.
This car is like a unicorn, it's magical.
WDSD at Newark Toyota World at East Cleveland Avenue and bring non-perishable items to the showroom for the second annual Fill a Tundra Food Drive. Receive a free pumpkin, compliments of Milburn Orchards when you drop off two non-perishable items to the Newark Area Welfare Committee, providing food for needy families this holiday season. It's tomorrow from noon to 2 p.m. at Newark Toyota World. Maine comes out with trips to the right side. Dan Collins has had a good day, 11 of 18, 173, and two touchdowns. He has thrown an interception, that interception coming late in the first half. Kenny Anawusi got his second of the season. Micah Wright's had a good day, 5 catches, 59 yards. Ernest Edwards, 2 for 62 and a score. We'll see what Maine does with Josh Mack back as the running back, and he gets the carry on first down. Goes center field, bounces it to the outside, 30. Across the 30, and still on his feet at the 35. Now he takes a blow from this, from Nassif, bounces backwards, and Josh Mack showing he's pretty hard to get down. They'll mark him at the 31-yard line.
That was a wild play, because what happened there was Mack got to the 25 and then cut it back and looked like it was going to be brought down at the 27, 28. He just ran through Adderley. It looked like they might blow Ford Progress down, but Delaware kind of relaxed. He ran through it. He spun away from two more. Then he got dragged back after he made it up to about the 33 or the 34, but he spun away from that, so he lost his forward momentum. Collins tried to come involved and push the pile forward, and Reeder knocked him to his backside.
A first down run, though, 11 yards for Mack, the National Freshman of the Week. Now he runs the outside, stiff arm against Jones, gets him to the 37-yard line, so a pickup about 6 on first down.
Well, they've really let both teams' offensive lines get away with grabbing. We've seen West Hills take advantage of that to get to the edge. I thought the Hens had a play or two where you could have easily thrown a flag for a holding that did not get called. Granted, they did just get the one on the last drive against Whaley. And that time, I thought it was a no-doubt-about-it hold. It looked like, to me, Kitchen just got completely grabbed and almost turned around. And you see a flag on that type of movement every time.
Second down and 4, Collins all day to throw, does so low for his target in Delaware territory at the 35, an incomplete fall.
Boy, Delaware, you'd like to use the saying, they owe somebody dinner. Delaware owes the main wide receiver core dinner today, because that's another ball. If he gets his head around, it's not a touchdown because it was a little bit of a low throw. He wanted to protect the receiver from the safety, but it's a 40-yard gain. I mean, it's in his hands. He just never turned to look for the football. Collins is having a great day. Stat-wise, he's been solid, but really he's been far better than even the stats would indicate.
He could be well over 250 yards and around 65% on the completion. Instead, 11 of 19, 173. Third down and 4. Collins throwing, has his tight end for a first down up to the 45-yard line. The catch was made by Jeremy Salmon, his first of the season, and Bell made the sack.
Just give him credit. I mean, they sit in a little zone there, finds a window at the sticks, provides a big target. Collins sees him, and it's easy pitch and catch. They end up having some problems with guys getting behind, so they have to soften things a little bit. They leave a pretty exposed zone center of the field that Maine take advantage of.
So second first down of this drive for Maine as they up their own 45. 7:54 and ticking, third quarter. Delaware up by 1, 14-13. Salmon, who just caught the pass, goes in motion. Give is to Mack, shuffles his Pete Jackson is there. Tackle for a loss by Anthony Jackson, his team high 4th of the season.
Great play by Jackson. They tried to go a little misdirection there. They had some pulling action, and Collins, the way he took the ball back, made it look like it was going to be a handoff left. They counter it back right, and Jackson stays at home on the backside, and again in the backfield. How many times have we said that about Jackson over the course of the first half of this season?
He's having a great start to this year. 4 tackles for loss, has 2 interceptions. And has found his spot on the outside of that linebacking field. Second and 11, a screen pass is caught by Reed into Delaware territory and almost a first down to the 46-yard line. The tackle made by Nasir Adderley, but it's going to be third down and short after a second and 11 play.
Low throw that time. It was oh so close to him taking a knee as he caught that football. Not sure how he kept that knee up off the ground, but then give him credit because he just put his shoulder down and bulldozed his way right to the edge of the marker.
2 first downs already for Maine on this drive. They'll go I form on third down and a yard from the Delaware 46. They trail by 1, 6:35, third quarter. Collins, play action. Here comes pressure. He's hit. He's dropped. Blah!
Tell you what happened. As they take the snap, play action, the tight end kind of got stuck in traffic trying to get off the line of scrimmage. Seemed like he collided with his own man. He was the primary target. They were trying to run a little corner flag there, and nobody back for Collins, and then Nichols just sheds the block. And I mean, he made that look easy. I mean, he pretty much ate Collins for lunch. And that's an interesting play call there from Maine. They got uber aggressive. They kind of gamble, and they come up snake eyes and have to put it away.
It's going to be Papali back to return on fourth down 11 after Nichols' first sack of the season. It's high. Under it is Papali, a fair catch.
Fair catch by number 13.
At the 12-yard line, a 44-yard punt by Will Stevenson with 5:42 remaining. In quarter number three, we'll take a break. Your PNC Bank timeout score remains Delaware 14, Maine 13.
Why choose it?
Want more Delaware Athletics content? Click around here on Hens All Access for live games, game highlights, features, and more. And follow your favorite Hens on Twitter for the latest updates.
It's your turn to mix it up at Mickey D's. For a limited time, choose any two. From mouth-watering new picks to tasty classics. McPick 2 for $5. Enjoy the choice.
Rush hour or relax hour, it's your choice. Ride more, save more, do more. Dart, moving forward.
Delaware Stadium Forces broadcast brought to you by Dash It. Nothing great was built on an empty stomach. Dash It now offers all new breakfast sandwiches on a warm buttery croissant roll. Try sausage, egg and cheese, bacon, egg and cheese, and double egg and cheese. Grab a 16-ounce Dash It coffee and a breakfast sandwich for only $3.50.
Rain picking up a little bit here, Scott.
To the advantage of Delaware, who runs the football and has a one-point lead. Maine, we've seen try to throw the ball. Here's Wes Hills, the reason why Delaware is so successful on the ground. He runs wide to left side, slow developing. He couldn't get up the field, but he did pick up a couple on first down. We'll get to the 16-yard line. That's a 4-yard run, not bad on first and 10.
He's a guy that's slippery enough as it is. When you add the rain to it, you're trying to arm tackle him. It just makes it that much more difficult. And they just seem to think they have the edge set. And then Hills gives him a little step forward and a spin to the outside and just keeps bouncing wider than the widest guy for the Maine defense. And you think that's a no gain. And you look up, he got 3.5, almost 4 yards.
Walker will go back in shotgun form on second down and 6. Ball on his own 16-yard line. Hills standing next to him, and he'll give it again to Hills. Check that. It's going to be Walker with the carry to the 21-yard line. He kept it himself on the QB read. And he picked up about 5, so it's going to be third down and about a yard for Delaware.
Well, he does finish runs for a quarterback. He's not a big guy in any way, shape, or form, but he does not seem to shy away from contact, and he finishes runs. He moves piles forward and just kind of lowered his shoulder, and instead of being 3rd and 3, worked his way to 3rd and 1.
4:40 and ticking, third quarter, Hens up by 1. Maine showing some pressure. As the Hens have it at their own 21 with Walker in shotgun form. Hills is the running back. Walker again with the carry. Gets what he needed. A yard, maybe a yard and a half, but he'll move the sticks.
They had to shell out if they were going to try to stop Les Hills shot the first down. So everybody coming downhill Hills' direction. And that was an easy first down pickup, but a painful one for Walker because he knew he was going to take a shot. And boy, you want to be careful getting your quarterback hit like that too often. But you needed the first down there, and you liked it, Walker. Was willing to do
it. A couple years ago, remember Trent Hurley never slid, and Walker showing that he's got some strength when he runs the football. 1st and 10 from the 24 of Delaware. Bouncing in the backfield is West Hills looking for some space. Patiently finds it, but it closes. Still a 5-yard carry for West Hills. How he gets 4 or 5 yards on plays that seem like they're going to be zero or losses amazes me still every time.
He's got a Barry Sanders quality too. But I mean, decent job blocking up front there for Delaware, but we talked about an 8-man box, a 9-man box. That looked like an 11-man box that time. And I'm not even kidding. There was everybody within 7 yards of the line of scrimmage. Eventually, the Hens are going to have to try play action just to try to loosen it up a little bit.
It's 2nd down and 6, ball on the Delaware 28-yard line, 3:23. Randolph in the game, Walker in shotgun form. It's Randolph's turn, and he is eaten up in the backfield. That's Pat Ricard, the redshirt senior first-team All-CAA, and he has now 6.5 tackles for loss, a team high on the season after that one.
I mean, it's tough because it doesn't matter how good and how efficient you are in executing your stuff. when a defense knows you're going to run the football every single snap, and you're not hitting home runs. I mean, Hills hit some home runs in that first half. We talked about the need of that in the pregame show because you have one good set of downs, you get a first down, but now you got to run it three more times clean, and you get up a zero-yard gain, and now you end up in a passing situation, which is certainly not your strength.
It's third down and seven as the rain falls. Papali goes in motion, retraces to the left side. Walker awaits the snap. Now he gets it, looking right. Pressure comes. He throws. Cherry can't get to it. Walker now one of eight. And Will Stevenson, the punter, now back on the field.
And Joe didn't get any favors early. He's missed a couple throws here in the second half, but he's also locked on Cherry a little bit. Had some pressure. It's easy for me to sit up here and say, if you hold it a half more second, but he had Papali pop open center of the field, and I thought he had enough time to stay patient with it. He thought he anticipated Cherry would open, but he has to throw that ball to the boundary to avoid the undercut for the interception, and as a result, he's just too wide with it.
He just hasn't gone through his progressions this season. Cherry, obviously his favorite target, but you're right. Will Stevenson punts it away on fourth down and seven from the 27. Fair caught by Michael Wright.
Catch called for by number 10,
at the 34-yard line. A 39-yard punt for Will Stevenson, who's been busier than the Hens have wanted him to be in this ball game. The Hens still up by one, 14-13. Now 2:20 remaining in quarter number three. One of our listeners said, if you need to freshen up your house or you're like me and need to change the color of a new house, do what I didn't call J. Michaels Painting. Owner Mike is a Delaware grad and a huge Blue Hens fan. That was good enough for me. But beyond that, I trusted in his company's 25 years of experience. Their professional professional painters came into my house and left it looking fresh, clean, and new, all in one day's work. I got a free estimate and a free design consultation, which was so very helpful. You can too. Visit jmichaelspainting.com.
By the way, next week's opponent, William and Mary, hanging with JMU. Second half, only down seven.
Now Maine's drive will start on the 34, and they give to the running back. Gets to the 37-yard line.
Charles Bell.
It was Zaire Williams on the carry. 3-yard pickup on first down.
They use a lot of backs, try to keep everybody fresh. In and out, rotation, and that's a pretty good run by Zaire that time. Just West Hills type effort, kind of jump stop, jump cut out to the outside, and just kind of sliver his way for any open space.
Now Collins under center this time. They'll fake the end around and again go to Beckford. He gets the 40-yard line, 41. So two carries of 3 and 4 yards make it third down for Maine.
I got to defend everything if you're Delaware. The good news for the Hens, they lead, and the style of offense in this game has really shortened the contest. I mean, not a lot of possessions. The second time Maine's gotten the football in the second half, they're in a third down, and we're already almost at the end of the third quarter. So the style of football, despite the fact that Delaware has done virtually nothing in the second half offensively, has allowed the Hens to stay in the lead, but it just doesn't feel like they have much control of the game.
Maine, 3 of 8 on third downs. Third down and two now. Collins pumps, throws, a nifty pass sidearm to his running back, Nigel Beckford, at the 45. Then he dives ahead to the 48-yard line, and that's a first down conversion by the Maine Black Bears.
Not sure if that's a release for Beckford or a design play. If that's a design play, that's fantastic. No, that was just they were trying to get the ball to the outside, and Beckford's in there in protection. His man didn't blitz, so he leaks out to the marker. That's just great poise from Collins. He looks to the outside, wants to release the football. It's jumped by the corner, holds it on the pump, and then checks it down.
It's first and 10 for Maine. On the offset eye, they'll give it to the wide receiver on the end around. Jackson is there to bring him down at midfield. It was Marquise Adams with the run, a gain of about 3-2.
Samanovic tries to cut Jackson on the outside and gets a big piece of him. I don't know how Jackson stayed on his feet. That's fantastic balance. And then he hops up and goes and makes the tackle. And that's a really good play by Jackson and a very important one because I don't know about you, I didn't see many other defenders on that side of the field. I probably goes for at least 20 more if he doesn't make that tackle.
A big play by Anthony Jackson. It'll send us to the fourth quarter of action. A quick start to this second half. The third quarter in the books, and your PNC Bank timeout score, Delaware 14, Maine 13. You're listening to 94.7 WDSB.
Hey, bro.
Welcome.
How you doing?
Thanks for coming. Today, you're going to choose a mobile office to drive to a remote work site.
Okay.
You can choose this Chevy Silverado that offers built-in 4G LTE Wi-Fi, or you can choose this Ford F-150 that doesn't offer Wi-Fi. But to make up for it, we added a trailer, a satellite antenna, and Dolores.
Hey, fellas.
Technology's a little behind in here.
Now, the Silverado offers built-in Wi-Fi with a connection that's stronger than your smartphone.
Slick.
So which one do you want?
I'd pick the Chevy.
Silverado. It leaves Ford in the dust.
It just can't beat it.
And a goal! It's Delgado with his second.
Is the count here on 94.7 WDSD. You know, the Hens have been gone for quite some time. 37 days since Delaware beat Delaware State in the season opener, and now the Hens head to the fourth quarter with a one-point advantage over the Maine Black Bears. It's 14-13. I'm Scott Klatsky alongside Matt Janis, Michael Antonarase down on the sideline. One of our listeners at St. Francis Healthcare, they get their emergency patients out of the waiting room and into treatment fast, averaging a wait time of less than 32 minutes, and stroke and heart attack patients are seen immediately. At St. Francis, you'll find that fast, exceptional treatment is the rule, not the exception. St. Francis Healthcare, we treat your emergency with urgency.
I can't remember seeing a game where the teams are virtually identical in first downs. Hens with one more. Maine has a slight advantage in total yardage, and yet one team, or both teams really, are completely one-dimensional. Maine can't run the ball. Delaware can't throw the ball. Delaware literally has 0 yards passing right now. It's not like sacks are backing them up, because they count sacks as rushing yards in college football. They have 0 yards passing, only one completion in the contest to this point. But they have 213 yards on the ground, 145 of them coming from Wes Hills. Maine, meanwhile, 38 yards rushing, but 197 through the air.
Maine starts the fourth quarter with second and eight from midfield. Collin, ball deflected and batted around, incomplete. Very close to an interception from a lineman. Armin Ware was in the area. And Collins, I think, might have come over and just batted the ball down incomplete.
Oh, he absolutely did, and it's the play of the game because Ware picks that off. I don't think he goes for a touchdown, but he goes for a while, and it's Delaware ball in plus territory. Instead, Collins able to bust it up, and it's still a third down with the offense on the field for Maine.
Good awareness by Collins, the quarterback. Now third and eight from midfield. Collins throws one, lobs it, and it's caught at the 25-yard line for a first down by Jaleel Reed. That one had a lot of air under it, and Reed comes away with his team-high 15th catch of the season.
Good job of hand play that time from Reed. I thought it was enough of an extension to get him called for the offensive pass interference. Officials said the arm did not extend far enough, but it created just enough space between he and Casey Hinton. And that's just another good throw from Walker. He puts it up where only his receiver can get it. He seems to really enjoy those seam routes.
He's done quite the job today with him. Over 200 yards passing on 15 of 24. Now back under center is Collins. First and 10, approaching the red zone at the 24. A running play to the right side. It's Beckford, and he gets to the line of scrimmage, the 24. It was Jackson again.
Guess who? All over the place. They try a toss to the right, try to turn the corner running wide, and Jackson just chases it down. Jackson's the guy. His job is either make the tackle on the outside or force it back inside, and he did both. He forced him to cut inside, and he makes the stop. Fantastic play by Anthony Jackson, who has had a fantastic afternoon and a really strong start to his season.
It's Collins with trips out to the left side in shotgun form. Second down and 10 from the 24. Looking right, pumps, he's hit, and again it's Bilal Nickel.
That's just a crazy call by Maine. They're trying to run a screen. They're bluffing the quick throw right, and they have a wide receiver screen set to the left. It's too slow developing. Nichols lands and just crushes Collins. It was set up to the left, But Delaware's too athletic for that type of play all over Common to the backfield. And what they did was they knocked themselves out of field goal range. Now, I don't think Maine's playing for a first down anymore. I think they're playing for 7-8 yards to try to make this a manageable field goal.
Third down and 18 after Bilal Nichols gets his second sack of the game. Pressure comes again. Collins goes down again. He dropped the football, got back on top of it. Flags flying everywhere, back at the 42.
I think we got two flags. I think the linesman threw one down near the Delaware bench. And then the umpire threw one, too. They got two flags. The referee was going to call the hold on the main offensive line, but there's another one down here. And I'm worried this is holding on the Hens, which would be offsetting. No, both against Maine. Big break for Delaware.
Holding, offense, number 75. Holding, offense, the right tackle. Both penalties are declined. Fourth down.
Don't see the line judge call holding against the offensive line very often. Where he threw that flag, normally that's going to be a hold against the secondary. But as you watch the replay, it's a no-doubter. Great pressure from both edges. And the holds, I mean, easy calls. Denby got one, and then the other goes to Reddington. And it's the pursuit of the Delaware defensive ends that bails the Hens out.
A sack by Bilal Nichols and then the pursuit by Donaldson and Ware. Those are the two players that were held up. And the punt unit on for Maine when it looked like they were in good position to drive. It's going to bounce and roll into the end zone for a touchback.
Oh, what a huge, huge bounce for Delaware. They had three guys down there set up to down that ball inside the five, but with that awkward hop that it took, they get some space, they get out to the 20, and now they need to get that offense going.
Offense back on the field. When we come back, your PNC Bank timeout score, Delaware 14, Maine 13, 12, 28 to go in this one.
Shiraz.
They end 2015 with a road victory over Elon.
Our season ended at 255. At 256, a new season began. But we can't just talk about it. We've got to be about it. On the field, no one's spot is guaranteed. And in here, excuses don't matter. I'm going to work harder and longer than I ever have. Check your feelings at the door, because the bar has been raised.
Hello, Delaware fans. This is Coach Brock at beautiful Lums Pond State Park, just minutes from Delaware Stadium. I'm inviting you to come to the park, enjoy their year-round camping, boat rentals, equestrian center, and so much more. While you're here, experience the Go Ape Treetop Adventure. Go Ape is an outdoor experience where you can live life adventurously and experience the park from 50 feet up in the trees, hanging by a wire. To learn more about Go Ape or to book your visit to the course, visit www.goape.com. Go Hens!
Welcome back to Delaware Stadium. We're in the Valley Days broadcast booth presented by Shell. I'm Scott Klaskin with Matt Janis, Michael Anarase patrolling the sideline. And with 12:28 remaining in the football game, the Blue Hens holding on to a one-point advantage thanks to a missed extra point by the Maine Black Bears. Now the offense back on the field, a chance to add to it. This drive starts at their own 20, and the running back is Thomas Jefferson. And it'll be play action as Walker rolls out to the right side. Throwing, finds his man at the 25-yard line. A little dump-off pass and out to the 31-yard line. It goes, it's Vinny Papali. Vinny's second catch of the season, and maybe a Bronx cheer by the Delaware crowd.
It's a combo. It started as a Bronx cheer. Then I think it rose to appreciation for Papali's effort because he broke about three tackles to go get that first down, and then it went back to the Bronx cheer because they had zero passing yards before that play. But that is a phenomenal effort by Papali, an incredible play there.
Delaware went 3 minutes into the fourth quarter with zero passing yards, and finally a pickup of 10 on first down. Now Thomas Jefferson with no room to run. White jerseys in the backfield. And Darius Green again there. Also Chenna Ugwanwu, the sophomore defensive lineman, brings TJ down for a loss of two.
I mean, that's probably one positive pass play isn't going to make Maine play you honestly. You go right back to the ground, understandably so, because you just haven't done anything through the air. And you're very fortunate Brody Curran wasn't called for a hold that time. I thought a pretty clear grab of cloth. Maine got up very upset that they didn't get the flag, but either way, it's still a two-yard loss.
So Walker goes under center now. Second down and 12. Ball on his own 29-yard line. 11-21 and ticking in the third quarter. Three wide receivers. Cherry to the left side. Two wide receivers to the right. Papali and Jarman. The running back still Thomas Jefferson under center. Walker takes the snap. Gives to Jefferson. Looking for a blocker on the right side. Doesn't get much. And down he goes at the 30-yard line. A pickup of one. And Sterling Sheffield, the linebacker, made the tackle.
It's a stacked deck. I mean, you can be as athletic as you want. I mean, we've seen Wes Hills get stifled in the second half. There aren't many guys more athletic than him at the FCS level. They've tried to run between the tackles, and they're just not getting a push because there's too many guys to move. They've tried to run wide, and you can't beat four guys to the edge. They just have too much space covered.
See if the Hens can throw for a first down here as Randolph comes in, possibly to help block for Joe Walker on third and 11. From the Hens 30-yard line. In motion goes Scarf. And Walker will drop back. He has some time. Now rolling out. Dropping back. Still being pressured. He's going to tuck it at the 30. Runs into traffic at the 35. Down at the 36 is Connor Walsh. Stopped the play.
Well, Walsh really saved Maine that time. Walker did everything he could there. I mean, there is just so much that is wrong right now with Delaware's passing attack. They try the play action initially, an okay pocket for Walker, but not much time. He has to flush out left. And then when he tried to reestablish and look downfield, bodies at him in waves, so he tucks and runs. Walsh is way up the field. Give him credit for not quitting as he hustled down to go make the tackle from the backside and save the first down.
Stevenson back out to punt. Fourth down and five. From the Delaware 36, Micah Wright waving it as soon as it went in the air back at the 21-yard line in Maine territory. So Stevenson again booms one, no return, 43-yarder from Will Stevenson. And with 9:32 remaining, we'll take a break. Your PNC Bank timeout score, Delaware 14, Maine 13. Back in a moment on the Blue Hen Sports Radio Network.
Capriati.
Little details, truly a game of inches. Small things people don't see. It's about putting yourself in the best position. It starts here. The work isn't flashy. It's not glamorous, but it's necessary. Because after all, the future is now.
Hello.
Nice to meet you.
Welcome, welcome.
Today I'm going to show you the all-new 2016 Chevy Cruze and ask you what you think. But here's the catch. You can only answer in emojis. What emoji would you use to describe the design?
I think it's sexy.
It has available built-in 4G LTE Wi-Fi.
Rock on, that's excellent, we got Wi-Fi.
This car gets an EPA estimated 40 miles per gallon highway.
This car is like a unicorn, it's magical.
Punts it away. Maine with the football. 9:32 remaining. Delaware up 14-13. Not much doing here today at Delaware Stadium.
No, I mean, Delaware has 11 yards passing. Maine has 20 yards rushing. There have been some offensive movement, but it's been one-dimensional. By the way, kudos. Delaware field hockey beat Michigan today in a top 10 matchup. Wow. Across the street, 3-1.
Collins on the rollout play action. He throws one on a line to the 25-yard line and tackle made by Nasir Adderley as Michael Wright gets another grab.
Maine quick snap is there. Bring it up because, A, it's a huge win for Rolf Vanderkirk's program. B, it may have drawn the second loudest cheer of the day when they announced it just a couple of minutes ago. There has not been a ton to be enthused about. Wes Hills, a couple of magnificent runs, and then the Bronx cheer plus admiration for Vinny Papali's incredible effort on that one completion a couple of minutes ago. Other than that, it's just been kind of grinded out.
Great program, that field hockey program at the University of Delaware, so congratulations to them. And Davis Ray with the carry on second down and five from 26. Bell was there. Also Jalen Kindle on the stop. So third down here for me. Delaware can get a stop here, get the football back, put together a drive.
Heck, at this point, Scott, just wind the clock. I mean, you're just trying to put your head down and survive this. 8:30 to go. The offense has done virtually nothing in this second half, but the defense has stepped up and more than carried its weight. It allowed one drive and got off the field when it needed to.
Third down and three. Collins out of shotgun. Two receivers to his left. He throws that way, right with the reception at the 35, upfield to the 40. And down he goes at the 45-yard line. Charles Bell with the tackle. That's his ninth and team high in that category. But the Hens can't get a stop on third down.
Just playing with a little bit of a cushion on the outside because they've been beat vertically over the course of this game. So they're playing a little soft zone there. And a stop route. Good read by the quarterback, and it's a timely throw. I mean, you have to let go of that football on time. Dan Collins has done it all day long, and they keep the offense on the field as a result.
17 yards on that play to right. First and 10 at the Maine 45. Play action screen. He skips it to his wide receiver. Incomplete. It was Dan a forward Collins pass.
Incomplete.
So it'll be second and 10.
Second down and 10.
But it's just not a real great play to try against this Delaware defense. It goes right into their strength. I know that everything in football is chess, not checkers, so you're trying to set some stuff up down the line. So you have a couple of quick hitters trying to get that defense moving forward so you can hit one behind them. But they have tried three or four wide receiver screens in this second half, and zero have worked, including one that backed them up 11 yards and cost them three. Well, they trailed by one, 7:42 to go. Delaware's strength is playing towards the line of scrimmage. When they get down the field, it's where they have some issue.
Two tight ends set for Maine. They send Adams in motion. Collins throwing behind his target, Reed, at the 46-yard line. And it'll be third down and 10 after back-to-back incomplete passes thrown by the senior Collins.
Yeah, but it's a good job. Troy Reeder got his depth that time, and he took away the window. He couldn't leave the receiver there because Reeder was in the passing lane. He would have intercepted. So Collins kind of tried to put it into a tight spot, hope his receiver would stop, come back. But when you're running a slant, awful tough to get your feet stopped in time to reach back and catch that football.
7:39, clock stopped in the fourth. Delaware up by one, 41-13. Split back, so now Micah Wright goes in motion, and he'll be in the slot on the right side. Collins throwing right, and it's to Micah Wright, caught in Delaware territory. He races to the 38-yard line, and another third down and long converted by the Maine Black Bears. It was third and 10 that time, after a third and eight conversion just a few plays before.
Middle of the field, I mean, it's posts and seams. It's killed Delaware all day long. And that time it looked like they end up with a linebacker on the wide receiver. That's a mismatch you're going to take advantage of. You spread the Hens out. And another accurately thrown football by Collins.
Right with eight catches for 98 yards. After that one, play action. Collins sets his feet, throws up the field. It's caught by Salmon for the second time today inside the red zone at the 18, up to the 16-yard line. Salmon did not have a catch coming into this game. He has two big ones, 22 yards that time, and Collins is really making it look easy on this drive.
His corner route, a little bit behind his target, but it ended up being a break. If he throws that ball out in front, he runs his man into a huge hit. Instead, he spins away from the hit, and it's an easy catch. I mean, Collins is doing everything right, and he has gotten not much help from his targets, to be honest. They've dropped a bunch of balls, and yet he's still in position to give the Black Bears the lead.
In the red zone now are the Maine Black Bears. In motion goes Simonovic. They give it to the running back, Davis Ray, who spins his way to the 11-yard line, a pickup of five on first down. 6:23 and ticking. Maine down by one, 14-13.
Here's where you start to keep an eye on the clock if you're Delaware. You're not going to call timeouts here. But if they do two more plays and end up with a first down, you have to start to think about it because there's plenty of time left, but you're not an offense built to score in 2 or 3 minutes. You were able to execute a four-minute drill at the end of the first half, but you got two huge runs from Hills. You can't necessarily count on that.
In motion goes Adams from right to left on second down and five. Collins in shotgun, looking left, still looking. Lobs it to the end zone. Reed is open. Reed has a touchdown, and Maine has the lead.
Man coverage. Hens can't run with these receivers if they don't land pass rush wise. The vulnerability of this defense right now is running in space. It's just a little in-out move to the flag, kind of a post corner, and it's a perfectly floated football by Collins. Nice route to go inside out on Adderley, but you need time to set that one up, and the main front gave Collins the time he needed. And now you got to go for two to try to get a seven-point lead if you're Maine.
The score is 19-14. Maine leads. They missed the first extra-point try of the game, so now they have to go for two with 5:48 remaining in the fourth. Reed goes in motion. He just caught the touchdown pass. Collins out of shotgun. Has some time. Now pocket collapses. Being chased. Throws it. It's tipped. Ball's in the air. And it's caught somehow by Maine. The two-point conversion is good for the Maine Black Bears. It was up. It was tipped. And the Black Bears got it. It was Jaleel Reed who just caught the touchdown moments ago.
I think they were trying to pick it off and go the other way for two. And the ball off their hands tips into the air. Not once, but twice, I believe. I think he got deflected on two occasions. And Reed just hustling, caught it right on the plane of the goal line and just fell forward. And you know, Delaware's not played well today in any way, shape, or form. They've also caught no breaks. And that's a horrible combination. And they're in a bad spot right now.
Delaware down 21-14 after that one.
I mean, it got pressure on the two-pointer. They're chasing him down. He's giving ground. He throws it up. Reeder tips it in the air. Then a Delaware defender tips it, keeps it up afloat, and it just falls right into the breadbasket of the receiver. I mean, it's unbelievable that Reed had that ball just land right in his mitts. It bounced off of two different guys. Ray Jones was the second Delaware defender that had it bounce off of his hands. But after the first deflection, I understand Reeder trying to pick it. It's just going to knock it down mode. Intercepting it there does you no good. But it's easy to say that when you don't have a split second to make the decision.
The sky kick again, and the up man will take it at the 18. Actually, Adderley came up to get it running wide. Cuts up the kicker at the 30, but protection there for Maine at the 32-yard line. The tackle made by A.J. Dawson. Nice move to get past the kicker, though, by Nasir Adderley. So Delaware's offense back on the field. They have had nothing in the passing game. 2 of 9 goes Walker for 11 yards. Love to see Wes Hills back out. He is. 5:35, still a lot of football to be played, but the Hens need to march.
Here's the question. How aggressive does Maine get here? You're up 7. I would stay with what's worked and dare Delaware to beat you through the air. But we oftentimes see teams switch things up and get conservative here.
Whistle is blown.
Ruling on field. And the kick return to the 32-yard line. It's under further review.
Did he fumble it? I didn't see the ball pop out late. Seems like an odd thing to review.
Yeah, I missed that too, if that ball popped out late. But they're going to go up to the booth, as now in every CAA game, you'll have officials' reviews. And up in the press box here at Delaware Stadium on the far right side, we're here on the far left, they have a booth set up for review plays. Delaware has not been on the good side of reviews this season. They haven't put up on the board here, but this play is being looked at with 5:35 remaining.
I mean, I guess the thing that is disappointing about this, you look at the score, you know, 21 points. That's not a great day.
5:43.
Went to review to fix the game clock. I mean, it's good for Delaware. They need all the seconds they can get, but that's the officials got to pay attention on the field and know where the clock should be.
And the officials got to at least let us know that the review is for the play clock or the game clock and not make us think that we missed the fumble that didn't happen. So we were right. We didn't miss anything there. The officials did on the clock. So the Hens now have 5:43 to try to tie the score back up. The Hens led 14-13 before a Jaleel Reed touchdown a few plays ago. In shotgun, Walker to the running back. Hills burst to speed up the middle, meets the second unit at the 38-yard line, and down at the 39 he goes. That's a good first down play by Wes Hills.
And Maine changed their defense. All day long they've had guys creeping up near the line of scrimmage. They've been flooding the box, especially in the second half. Really not all day long, in the second half especially. And now they go back to their regular base set. Two safeties back away from the line of scrimmage. They've gone passive here. Let's see if Delaware can pound it and take advantage.
Second down and 3 from Delaware territory at the 39. And Hills again. Burst of speed again. Full head of steam. Hills breaking away at the 20 to the 15. 10. He limps into the end zone. A touchdown 61 yards for Wes Hills.
60
Much better blocking. Electricity of Wes Hills. Hopefully he's all right, as he does not look 100% right now. But why would you change it up if you're Maine? Again, they have two safeties back, 15 yards of regular defensive set. The base set that they used for the first half, where Hills gashed them. They had adjusted to basically cover zero in the second half. Everybody up on the line of scrimmage. And now when you take a lead, you're thinking that you have an opportunity to kind of just sit back and make Delaware work for the yards. The ground attack gets some space, and it doesn't take much room for this home run to get hit by Hills.
Wes Hills ran for 212 against Delaware State. It's the fifth highest rushing total in a single game this season. He's got 213 after that one, and Arago's extra point ties it up at 21-all, 5:01 remaining. That's your PNC Bank timeout score. We'll be back in a moment on 94.7 WDSD.
How you doing?
Thanks for coming. Today you're going to choose a mobile office to drive to a remote work site.
Okay.
You can choose this Chevy Silverado that offers built-in 4G LTE Wi-Fi, or you can choose this Ford F-150 that doesn't offer Wi-Fi. But to make up for it, we added a trailer, a satellite antenna, and Dolores.
Hey, fellas.
Technology's a little behind in here.
Now, the Silverado offers built-in Wi-Fi with a connection that's stronger than your smartphone.
Billy is there again, and near midfield at the Delaware State logo. Ray Jones is down, so the team on the field to get to him. A Newark urgent care injury break as Ray Jones gets looked at.
He just ran through Jones, and Jones, his arm got kind of twisted back, and he's holding that right arm right now. You just hate to see that when guy comes forward with as much momentum as he had, back's going full speed, and he doesn't quite get it squared up. When that bicep gets twisted back, you always worry about it, but no, Jones, tough guy. He sits up now, and Dan Watch, an athletic trainer, and his staff out to check on him. But it's just unfortunate, just about a little tad off with that angle there from Jones. It cost him the opportunity to make the tackle, and more importantly, it cost him to go down here, and he's an important part of this defense.
He sure is. Jones, 16 tackles on the year coming in, led the team with 3 pass breakups. The good sign is he's kind of waving his arm, shaking it in the right arm as he comes to the sideline, but running off the field on his own strength, and he's not going far. His feet on the sideline as he just kind of shakes his arms. That's a good sign for Ray Jones. That's your Newark urgent care injury break.
Well, you just marvel at what these guys are able to do. I mean, you lose track of it sometimes, the toughness physically and mentally that they show, and you got to love a kid like Ray Jones.
3:26 and ticking for Maine, back on the field after the injury. Second down and 3 for Collins. It's Williams running left, has a hole, hits it at the 30 down the sideline, 25. Pushed out by Charles Bell, who's in double-digit tackles with 13. And Maine again approaching the red zone.
Another bounce out. It looked like Troy Reader tried to come in, plug the hole in tight, lost leverage to the outside, and he's able to bounce it out. It's designed to go left guard. And Reader just got caught in traffic trying to fill the hole, and he just slides left and works his way to the open space.
It's a 19-yard carry for Zaire Williams, the transfer from Temple. 3 minutes remaining, tie score at 21. Collins catches the shotgun snap. Again, it's Williams, this time up the middle into the hands of Troy Reader, who wraps him up at the 12.
Now, this is disheartening because, you know, maybe it's the over-adjust, the pass that you were getting beat by. So you back up, and you're a little softer, a little less aggressive. But, you know, you're getting gashed on the ground right now. As Dave Rock said at halftime, they can't run the ball on us, and they have it all day long until you get into a spot where you can't afford them to, and here they are doing it at will.
Single back is Williams. Williams has had success on this drive. 8 carries, 47 yards today. Counter play, he runs left, and Nichols is there to make the stop at the line of scrimmage. Blount Nichols having a heck of a game. Certainly his best game of the season. He came in with 4 tackles. He has 2 sacks, 6 tackles in this one alone. Now Delaware going to call a timeout. And as we look up at the big board at Delaware Stadium, Wes Hills has returned to the sideline, and he is on the bike on that sideline.
Gatorade in hand, which is a good sign that he's trying to get some fluids in there, and hopefully he's all right, because certainly you're going to need him right now. I mean, Maine is in field goal range. Nothing a sure thing. Of course, as we mentioned, Delaware hasn't played well, but they also haven't caught many breaks today. The rain has subsided here over the last 10, 15 minutes. You wouldn't mind wet conditions on a potential kick that might be coming to try to give Maine the lead.
And not a very steady field goal kicker for Maine. Patrick Leonard, looking at his stats, 1 of 4 this season. He missed the extra point earlier today. He's made a 29-yarder, but anything above that he has missed, from 35, 37, 47. However, the fact that you're trying a 47-yard field goal means that Coach Harris Simiak must have some confidence that he can kick from long range.
But this would be outside 29. This would be 34 if they don't gain another yard, maybe even 35. And remember, he hit the upright with an extra point earlier in the game, just yanked one.
Big play here as Maine in the red zone. Tie score 21-all. We talked about how much on the line today in this game. It's third down and 3.
Two timeouts left for Delaware. You get a stop with the ball in play, you're certainly calling another one here.
Third down and 3 for Collins. Two tight ends to the left. Collins is in shotgun form. Two wide receivers stacked to the right side. That's where Collins will roll. He throws it behind Wright, and Wright can't come back to haul it in. He had it in his hands, and it fell to the turf here at Tubby Raymond Field.
Again, they got beat to the outside, but Collins, for the first time today, inaccurate. It's a tough throw, rolling right. He had some pressure. He's giving ground, but he just missed that throw. That's a first down if he puts it on the money. You'd like his receiver to be able to make him right there, come back and corral that when he got both hands underneath of it. But now all attention turns to the kicker.
This will be a 35-yard try. Leonard has not made from longer than 29 this season. And a timeout's going to be taken. Maine icing themselves as the Black Bears will take a timeout on fourth down and 3.
Well, you want to make sure everything's set up here. The last thing you want to do is allow a field goal block. You want to give your kicker every opportunity. They were a little late sending the field goal unit out. They were a little disorganized. So, you don't ever want to give a young kicker an opportunity to think about it a little bit longer, but you also want to make sure that his kick has a chance to get to the uprights. He can't go through if it doesn't get there. So to make sure everything's set up blocking-wise, I don't mind the timeout so much if you're me.
And he is a youngster. 2 kickoffs last season versus New Hampshire. That's the only play time he got as a freshman. Now in his sophomore campaign, talking about Patrick Leonard, who will kick this field goal for a lead with 2:08 remaining. Remember, Maine took the lead and got a 2-point conversion to make it 21-14. West Hills answered. We don't know yet if we'll have West Hills after this play when the Hens get the ball back, either with a tie score or down by 3.
Well, you feel like you've been outplayed today. These are the type of games, though, if you sneak a win, it maybe changes your entire season. Can you catch a break?
Salmon will snap. Collins will hold. Leonard from 35 yards. It's in the air, and it's no good. The game is still tied at 21.
Well, everything was perfect except for the kick, Scott. I mean, he had plenty of leg on it. Snap was there. Spot was down. He got the ball rotated. He just yanked the kick. Oh, what a big break for Delaware. What a big stand by the defense when they needed to stiffen. And now the question is, can Wes Hills go? It looks like he can. I would just give the ball to number 31, and if he breaks a big one, great. If not, I got a better kicker. We'll play it for overtime.
Yeah, Rago can certainly kick. You remember last year, the game winner, his time expired against William & Mary. Rago's career long is 45. That against Lafayette in 2015. He made 10 a year ago. Hens don't have that on their mind. They have Wes Hills on their mind. He's back out there as a Hens break huddle. This drive will start on a Hens 20 with 2:05 remaining and the score tied. Hills to the right of Joe Walker, the quarterback. Gets the snap, does Joe. He'll keep it. Runs to the right and can't get past Darius Hart, who did a good job of staying at home.
Now take your time here if you're Delaware. They're going to hurry, and they call the timeout. I'm a little surprised. I thought you might take your time, not wind it all the way down, but just, you know, run 20, 25 seconds and make sure no matter what happens, Maine doesn't get the football back, and then see if you can take your chances to hit something big. But Dave Brock, he said when he got here 4 years ago, play an attacking brand of football. We're not going to play a passive brand of football. And that was tested a couple weeks ago when, you know, they didn't try to score at the end of the half against JMU, kind of ran the clock out. Well, there's nothing passive about this. He's all in on this offensive possession, because by calling that timeout, they don't pick up the first down here. Maine will get the football back, and they'll get it back with a reasonably short field, because I think the Black Bears will think about calling a timeout if you don't get much here on this second down play. So you've got to make sure you get a first down here on these next two snaps more than anything else.
Delaware will have one timeout remaining after this. 1:58 left in this ball game. Delaware 288 of their 299 total yards on the ground. Maine 375 total yards, 307 through the air. Most recently, Wes Hills found the end zone from 61 yards away. He was injured on the end of that run, but he's back in. Hills, a phenomenal day, 213 yards rushing on 22 carries. And you got to think his 23rd is coming up. After the timeout, ball on the 22-yard line of Delaware. Walker in shotgun form, two wide receivers to his left, two to his right. And it's Wes Hills to the outside left at the 30. Room to run at the 40. Cuts it to the outside at the 50. Down the sideline, flag thrown as he gets into Maine territory at the 44. Wes Hills again. Big work.
Yeah, but it's going to be a hold on Papata. You're still going to get a big gain, but you're going to go back to about your own 38, 39-yard line. He just didn't need to do it. I like that he's trying to make a play, but you already had huge yards. Actually, I'm sorry, it might have been Jarman, I beg your pardon.
Clock in the back, number 6 to the offense. 10-yard penalty, result of the play, is a first down.
Jarman lost leverage. I thought Papali, I saw the wrong number. Jarman lost leverage, and he just kind of shoved in the back of the shoulder and then knocked the shoulder pad out. And the thing about it is, Wes is already 25 yards up the field. Even if he gets tackled at midfield at the 45, you're in really good shape. Now you back up all the way to the 38-yard line. You can still hit another big one from Wes, which he has proven he's capable of at any second. But with only one timeout, 1:48 to go, and no real passing attack, you're still in a tough spot here to try to get points.
Ball goes back to the 39-yard line after the penalty in Delaware territory. Randolph is in as the running back with two wide receivers to both sides of Joe Walker. Maine stacking the box. It's Randolph this time. Trying to turn the corner, cannot, but he does drag a defender from what would have been a loss to a gain of two to the 41-yard line, second down and 8.
Last timeout called here by Delaware.
The final timeout of the half.
I mean, the nice part here is, we talked about it with that second kicker, the opportunity with Roth, you know, probably maybe try one from 55. I mean, he hasn't been kicking the ball as far towards the Carpenter Center tonight with the damp conditions, a little cooler. It's not flying as well, but you don't have to get to the 25. You get to the 38, 37, you might be willing to give your big leg kicker a chance, but at a timeout, you're only going to have so many snaps here if you keep running the football, which I fully expect the odds are Delaware will do.
Rago, you mentioned, is the field goal kicker, but you're right. Jake Roth has been mentioned. If it's above 52, 53, he's got the leg to give it a try. Roth has not attempted a field goal yet, a true freshman walk-on.
I mean, I have full faith in Rago. He's been solid this year. If you get to the 30-yard line, you know, you feel like Rago's going to knock it through. But that's 30 yards in less than 90 seconds with no timeouts, and you have 11 yards passing. Certainly possible, certainly what you're aiming for, but, you know, it's not something that you're necessarily counting on right now.
Delaware on second down and 8, 1:28 to play after the timeout. Well, Hill's back in as the running back. He'll stand to the right side of Joe Walker. Ball on the near side has two wide receivers to the left, Cherry to the right. And it's Walker dropping back, being pressured, throws to an open Hills, who catches it at midfield, spins away from a tackler momentarily, and falls at the 45-yard line in Maine territory. Clock momentarily stopped at 1:20.
How do you lose Hills? Hills stays in the block, just leaks out. Nobody went with him. It's a good recovery at the last second by Lowe, but what a job by Walker to find his playmaker.
Walker out of shotgun again, takes the snap, a passing down, throws it, and it's caught by Whaley. He's rocked out of bounds after the completion at the 40-yard line. Darius Hart with the tackle. Nice grab by Brandon Whaley, and Joe Walker picked a good time to complete his first back-to-back passes of the game.
Brock thought it was targeting near the sideline. He went after the official, trying to get the free 15. But because that ball goes out of bounds, that was huge to save time. Now you have plenty of opportunities to just take your time, take a breath, and go right back to Hills here.
No timeouts for Delaware. 70 seconds left. Tie score, 21-21. Delaware going to spread it out. Four wide receivers, two to both sides. Wes Hills is the running back. Walker with the snap and the handoff to Wes Hills. He fumbled the football. Wes Hills fumbled the football, and Maine picks it up, running down the sideline. Maine taking the fumble down the sideline at the 20, at the 10, cutting it back and scoring a go-ahead touchdown. In the fourth is Austin Brown with only 56 seconds left. Unbelievable.
A shocking turn of events. It looked like Hills was going to break that tackle, break into the second level, and it had been in field goal range. We said a couple of times earlier, he lost one, he came close to losing another, and the ball just bounced, popped right up into the air. And we mentioned Maine's best defensive player out of the game. His understudy ends up picking the ball up and returning the fumble for the touchdown to take the lead. There are not words.
Wow. Extra point by Leonard is through, and with 56 seconds left, what a turn. What a turn of events here at Delaware Stadium. I mean, Christoph Malumba Chimanga, perhaps the best defender in the league, out today. The person replacing him, Austin Brown, picks up the fumble, runs down the sideline, and scores with 56 seconds left to give the Maine Black Bears a 7-point advantage.
There is still time here, but you have no timeouts. And again, 30 yards passing. I mean, you were talking about a deck being stacked against you. A little surprised they don't put Wes Hills back here to kickoff return. I know he is a little emotional right now. They got guys going to him, to a man, trying to pick him up. Let's be honest, without Wes Hills, they would not have been in any position to even be in this game, let alone to try to win it at the end. But what a terrible time for that to happen. And now, boy, do you ever need a return. Adderley or Ray Jones, who is back out there, which is nice to see. Maine's going to take a timeout to just make sure they get this thing covered, because honestly, you don't see this very often, but you feel like this might be one of Delaware's best chances at a score. They don't necessarily need to return it for a touchdown, but I mean, if they start at their own 20, own 30-yard line, you can't really foresee a way, realistically, with the way this game has gone and the way this season has gone, the way the last two seasons have gone, that the Hens can put it into the end zone through the air. But if you can sneak this one out to the 40 or the 50, if you're Maine, I might even consider they've gone sky kick most of the day, but Delaware's come close to breaking a couple. Maybe you squib it, you keep it on the ground just to take away the opportunity of the Hens hitting a home run.
You mentioned Wes Hills. He does have the longest return of the season, a 50-yarder. But he will not be out there, as Yoakum will be the up man. This year, Adderley is back to return for Delaware.
Yeah, now I think they want to get Hills out there. Now they changed their mind last second. Hills tried to work his way onto the field. He went out towards the numbers, and then the coaching staff grabbed him back. Maybe West tried to put himself in there.
56 seconds. You can imagine what Wes Hills is thinking right now. He wants a chance to get back out there and do something big. Leonard boots this one away. First time a returnable kick for Adderley from the 2 at the 10-yard line, 15 now at the 20, spinning, still up at the 25-yard line, breaks it at the 30. Oh, he was close. He was close as he goes down at the 32 for something special to happen on that return. A nice effort by Adderley, but Delaware will have 48 seconds, no timeouts, down 7, and they'll start this one at their own 32.
Devon and Williams hanging on for dear life. Adderley, I mean, a good spin to break free of one, but Devon just would not let go, and he's still down on the field. I thought he was out of there, and it was just the kicker to beat. If he pops out of that pile, maybe to go for a touchdown, at least you're going to get into Maine territory. Now, you know what? You haven't done anything all day, but you still got 48 seconds. Now's the time to – there's nothing to lose. You don't have to protect the football anymore if you're Joe Walker. Everybody's got to be ready to get up the field. You can use the center of your field, obviously, in a college game with the clock stopping and a timeout. You don't have to use the sideline. If you run, if you're Joe Walker, though, you've either got to get the first down or you've got to get to the sideline. You cannot get tackled inbounds shy of a first down because you're going to be running a lot of vertical rounds. A lot of people way down the field is going to take too long to get back and spike the football and get the clock stopped.
Delaware has 30 yards passing today. They'll need to add to that total. On this drive, down by 7, 48 seconds left. Walker pointing out directions to his offensive line. It's first and 10 from the 32 of Delaware, and here's Walker. Pressure coming from McCarr, they pick him up. Walker down the middle of the field, some contact incomplete. He was looking for Papali at around the 37-yard line of Maine. A good defensive play that time by Maine.
Darius Hart playing center field there, and Hart kind of read that play the whole way, broke to the spot, thought Papali might be able to get inside position on him, but give Hart credit. He went up, got it at its highest point. Papali actually ended up turning into a defender and made a pretty good job to nudge him, avoid the interception, at least give your offense another shot.
Walker, 4 of 12 today for 30 yards, 42 seconds. Delaware down by 7 after Austin Brown returned a fumble for a touchdown to give Maine the lead while Delaware was driving. Now the Hens have the football back. Walker in shotgun. Throwing towards the sideline. High for Jarman and incomplete. It's third down.
First half, Joe Walker just didn't get much help. Couple of drops. A lot of pressure. Second half just hasn't been as accurate as we have seen him be at times this year. He had come so far in that area. I know the stats don't back it up, but the drops really have killed him so far this season. In this second half, he just has not been sharp when Delaware's really needed him to be.
Getting down to the final chances for Delaware. 36 seconds left. And again, Walker will be in shotgun form. Jarman to the right, two wide receivers to the left, Papali and Cherry. Randolph is the back to help block. Walker looking, throwing. And it's caught by Cherry at midfield. The clock will stop momentarily to move the sticks. 30 seconds.
Should spike it here to stop the clock.
They should clock this.
Oh, they got up in a hurry here.
They're going to run a play. And some movement by Vince Papali, who just ran up the field.
And that's why I think you spike the ball there. I mean, you're only going to be able to run so many plays as it is. You want to preserve clock and get everybody organized.
Papali with a head start. We'll hear what the call is.
It's going to be a false start. You got to get up on the ball and be ready here because the ball is going to...
Offense, number 13, 5-yard penalty. There will be a 10-second runoff. Please set the game clock to 15 seconds. 15.
That's killer.
And it's going to run when he puts the ball down, so you got to be ready to go.
On my signal.
Walker out of shotgun, 15 seconds on first and 15. Hands down by 7. They need a miracle. Walker being pressured, runs out of pocket. Throws it down the field. It's caught by Papali inside the 30. They've got to get up and spike it. The clock stopped at 5 seconds. They've got to spike the football to get one more play.
They should be able to get this done. Make sure everybody is set and in legal formation.
Clock runs at 4. Walker spikes it. And we'll have one more play in this ball game.
Well thrown ball that time by Walker. He had to break the pocket, broke contain, pretty much what we saw Collins do most of the first half, buy some time, and then just a very accurate throw on the move. And now Walker's athleticism can be used to his advantage. If he can buy some time and then you spread everybody out in the end zone, you hope that you can find just a little bit of space that you take advantage of. You're close enough where he can throw a bully. He doesn't have to throw a Hail Mary type pass.
Ball will start on the 29-yard line. Final play of the day. Trip to the right side. Cherry split out to the left. 4 seconds remaining and Maine up 28-21. From the 29, here's the final play. Joe Walker, no pressure, throws it up for grabs in the end zone, and it's incomplete. That's how the ball game will end. A heartbreaking loss against the Maine Black Bears. And Delaware falls 28-21. Tough one today, Matty.
They went the Hail Mary route there. They just flooded the back right corner of the end zone. It's three-man rush and just too many bodies around. Walker gave his receiver a chance. He floats it to the back. Ahead did get his hand on it, but there were two Maine defenders right there, and just they did the right thing. They batted it down, and that's a crusher. I mean, honestly, Maine outplayed Delaware today, but the Hens were in position to steal the game. And to have, I mean, he's your best player, and he was almost single-handedly propelling you to victory. Have that time to fumble the football, your heart just breaks for West Hills. It really does.
Delaware would not have been in the game, you mentioned that, without West Hills. 242 yards rushing, two touchdowns. But what will be remembered, unfortunately, is that fumble at the end. And that's just the way sports goes, unfortunately. You remember what happened last? And what happened last was West Hills losing the football and Austin Brown taking it for a score. So much was on the line in today's game. And for Maine to improve to 2-3 on the season, Delaware to drop to 2-3, more importantly, 0-2 in conference play. It's tough to swallow right now for Blue Hens fans, for the Blue Hens players, for the coaching staff, for everybody involved. Just a heartbreaking way for this football game to end when you really felt so good about what Delaware was about to do on that drive.
I mean, I don't know where they go from here, but we'll talk to Dave Brock in a little bit. And, you know, if it would have been one of those games where Delaware was in control the whole way and statistically had the edge and was out playing Maine and that fumble happens, maybe it would be a different feeling right now. But to be honest, it was the other way. I felt like you kept looking up at the scoreboard. How's Maine not winning this football game? How are they not ahead by more? They got the break of the missed field goal, and then to their credit, they executed in the last 4 minutes of the first half. They were executing here on this last drive, fourth quarter, but the ball pops free, takes a perfect bounce, and I mean, it just erases in the blink of an eye, but it's not like they played well before it.